just thought football was done? No, my friend, no. Tarleton State, the Texans, bring in McNeese State here in Stephenville, Texas at Tarleton Memorial Stadium. I'm John Little, joined by Scott Garner, and the rumors are true, Scott, football is back tonight.
It's back, but it's also cold, and these two teams are not accustomed to having not only to play in these frigid temperatures, but also practice in the week leading up to tonight's game, but never mind all of that. It's here, and they're ready.
Cold, not the only thing these two teams have been fighting through this offseason. First of all, any team that wanted to play football, the FCS moved their championship to the spring. Tonight's the opener, 19 more games next week. Tarleton finally getting to make their D1 debut. McNeese has been through a ton in the last 6 months.
They have. Not just one hurricane, but two. And the last one put them back. They couldn't practice until November. And at that, it was at a local high school.
Let's have some fun tonight. Tarleton State against McNeese State. The Texans coming to the field. Kickoff is next on Fox Sports Southwest. Into Memorial Stadium, John Little back with Scott Garner. The first FCS game of the year, and it is cold. Let's take a look at the weather for today's game. Not what you would normally think of when you're talking about the hill country of Texas, but it's 27 degrees. The wind's out of the north to make it worse, so it feels like it's in the teens, Scott.
Incredible how these two teams get ready for a season, and you know, football usually is a hot weather sport. It's turned into a cold weather sport for these two teams to start. But they wouldn't have it any other way. And Tarleton head coach Todd Whitten mentioned coming into the ball game that he didn't care. He was going to get his players out there. They were going to go head-to-head for 2 hours hard on Wednesday, Thursday, and they're ready to go.
Frank Wilson making his debut as the head coach at McNeese. Meanwhile, for Tarleton, the all-time winningest head coach in Tarleton State history, Todd Whitten, is in his 12th season with three different stints.
Yep.
And this might be the most special year as he takes the team from Division II, making the jump to Division I.
You know, and McNeese was the team that he had to play his very first game in his third stint. Didn't turn out as he would have liked, but he hopes things are a little bit different today. And this is the first game ever for Tarleton State as a Division I team. Stephenville being a football town, they're ready for it.
Incredible. Look at the way Tarleton's getting into it. They had to wait from the fall to the spring to get their season started. Same story for McNeese. They will also play a Southland Conference schedule. McNeese, a tradition-rich FCS squad. They've had winning seasons for 15 years in a row. Bailey Rayborn to kick off for the McNeese Cowboys in his junior season. And for the Tarleton Texans, Kalen Horton back deep to receive. There is a stiff breeze at the back of McNeese as they kick off. An early flag on this first kickoff, and it is returned by Horton. Horton has a little bit of room, slips through a tackle out to the 22-yard line. There is a flag on the field, though. It's going to be offsides on the kickoff.
We've got two flags, actually. We've got one thrown from the goal line by the referee. This is probably going to be going against Tarleton. Maybe an offsides against McNeese. We'll see what they decide.
Yeah, see if we have to re-kick this thing.
I thought maybe the initial flag that came out might have just popped out on the reverberation of that cannon that went off.
Vidal Jones is our referee. And Jones waiting for the mic
there
to work.
There are two fouls on the play. Side four, kicking team. Holding number nine. They offset. We re-kick.
Yeah, we got to do it again. So we get another opening kickoff to start the FCS season.
Yeah, and you know, as if things weren't cold enough out here, they delay things a little longer, getting things going. But you know, this Tarleton team, they come in under the direction of Todd Whitten, as you mentioned. This is third stint, and John, for whatever reason, Todd brings such a feeling of toughness and a guy that can battle adversity, and we'll see how Tarleton comes in. Interesting, they win the toss and they elect to receive the ball rather than defer.
Absolutely, they want to see what this offense has, and it's been such an explosive offense the last 2 years. The team's been 23-2. the offense in Division II has been top three in yards per game both years.
And if you look at the numbers, almost 500 yards a game, 500 in the regular season last year. That was tops in the Lone Star Conference, giving up just 269 per contest. Tarleton has been an offensive team the last couple of years. Going to be hard to operate in these conditions tonight.
So Rayborn, that first kick, yeah, that one didn't count. We do it again. This one is cleaner, and we're back underway with Horton letting it go over his head. Rayborn using the wind behind his back. And for the Tarleton Texans, they turn to a new quarterback after 2 years of Ben Holmes, replacing him, number 11, Stephen Duncan, big kid, transfer out of Western Kentucky.
Yeah, he's good. This is a guy that won the starting job at Western Kentucky in 2019. After three games, though, he got hurt, and we didn't see him from that point. But just for the mere fact that they go with him winning that job, he went 70 of 119, completed almost 60% of his passes. He's good in the pocket, and he's gotten better at getting the ball out on time.
And Duncan coming off that foot injury, but completely healthy now. Khalil Banks is the starting running back with him out of the 25-yard line as Tarleton takes their first snap as a D1 program. And Tarleton has been a pretty good running team over the last few years, trying the middle. Banks just not going down easily. Banks picking up four on the play on first down as Isaiah Chambers, a standout defensive end, a transfer from Houston, makes the play.
See them go quickly. They want to go tempo. McNeese and that standard 4-2 nickel.
Quick throw to the outside, and the first catch trying to slip away is J.F. Thomas. But Andre Sam, a veteran quarterback, does not let the All-American candidate get free, just a gain of one.
Boy, they don't waste any time. Get the ball in their playmaker's hands on the edge. J.F. Thomas, the senior, 6'5", 190, going up against Andre Sam. He's the best defensive back that they have in that backfield. That's a nice open field tackle right there at the line of scrimmage.
It's be a great matchup to watch all game long. An early third down for Stephen Duncan and the Tarleton Texans. May have jumped offside. We'll see. Quick cut, in cut route. Great coverage on Tariq Boston as Colby Richardson knocked it away.
Yeah, Masri Mapu and Peterson ended up running a twist in the middle, but Mapu jumps early, the junior transfer from the University of Louisiana Lafayette. He and Chambers and Kinsey really give that defensive front a chance to get better and a chance to be better immediately, but still, it forces Tarleton into a punt.
Yeah, not able to get into the neutral zone was Mapu. So waiting back deep, here is Mason Pierce, and the new punter this year for Tarleton is Jake Walrath, a transfer out of Utah State. Could be an adventure day in the kicking game, but a pretty nice punt into the wind, and the catch is made at the 36-yard line by Mason Pierce, sliding onto his stomach. And the Tarleton Texans go three and out to start this game. But McNeese State gets the ball for the first time, and you get a chance to see the son of Coach O up next. He will run the quarterback spot coming up here on Fox Sports. Bill, Texas, for the FCS opener. Welcome back in. The McNeese Cowboys get their first crack at it with Cody Orgeron, the returning starter at quarterback.
Yeah, Orgeron, a three-year letterman, the senior. He's had a couple of big years under his belt. Again, he's completed about 59% of his passes, almost 2,700 yards last year.
Had a really nice season and gives it to Deontay McMahon, who is a JUCO transfer for a one-yard gain. Devin Hafford, a cornerback who missed a lot of last year with an injury, comes in for the stop.
Yeah, going to see a lot of the ground game. Deontay McMahon, junior transfer. He's new. Probably the best running back that McNeese has had in maybe 10 years. He's that good. And again, he's out of Butte College, a transfer from Butte College.
For second and nine, Orgeron gives a look to the sideline. The offensive coordinators Ronnie Letson and the head coach Frank Wilson spent the last five seasons at UTSA, skews to the offensive side as well. Orgeron putting it in the air. A lot of cushion on the outside for Severin Foster. First down and more into Tarleton territory. Hafford forces him out.
Yeah, they run that zone coverage, off coverage at that. He had about 6-7 yards of cushion. As you mentioned, had a chance to run away from Ronnie Franklin, the cornerback, Foster, the Rochester, Minnesota college transfer.
15-yard pickup into Tarleton territory. First down at the 47.
You see that? Just put a move and had great space there to do it.
Orgeron, the ball is there right as Kalen Horton, the cornerback, makes a hit on the intended receiver, Severin Foster, second and 10.
By the way, if that name Orgeron sounds familiar, this quarterback from McNeese, it should. Ed Orgeron's son. And he's a guy that, again, a coach's son. He's smart, great passer, but he's much improved, and he keeps getting better with each and every successive season for McNeese.
There's a reason for that. He didn't always play the quarterback spot. More on that in just a second after this second down play. So Orgeron goes back to the ground game, and a little slice off the left side for Deontay McMahon, churning up yards for a gain of 8, leaving a third down and short. Yeah, Orgeron was really a tennis star back in high school and was only 5'4" as a freshman, didn't even get into being the starting quarterback till he was a senior. And McMahon is able to roll forward and pick up the first down.
Yeah, you know, he's just a great athlete. And Orgeron, it just tells you about the confidence that they have and had in him. A great decision maker. I like how McNeese is, though, staying with the ground game. They went with the inside zone run two plays ago, then ran the midline just a moment ago, doing a really good job between the tackles. This is going to be a tough matchup for this Tarleton defensive front.
First down at the 36. Another give to McMahon. Nice little cut, but he runs into his own man. Gets taken down from behind by Jordan Wells, Lone Star Conference Defensive Lineman of the Year in 2019.
Incredible ball get off. You're talking about a guy that can dip and rip. Certainly a lot more talented than most D tackles. You see, he's not that big. Senior, they list him 6 feet, 275, and he's a guy that can press and shed and get to the football.
For the second down and long, another look to the sideline by Orgeron. Pretty nice first drive for McNeese.
Well, this McNeese offensive front, big and imposing.
Another one to McMahon. And he's able to fall forward for a pickup of 3. Leaves a third down and 5. Ronnell Wilson has 214 career tackles coming into this one. Makes the stop from the linebacker spot.
Yeah, and McMahon finding either Nick Holliday or Hayden Shaw to run behind. Shaw, that 6'3 freshman at 285 at that guard and tackle position, ran behind Holliday a couple of plays ago. He knows where those big boys are, and they're getting a good push right now. It's a tough call right here. Third down and 5. They've been running the football well. Most teams would throw it here.
Third down's not kind to McNeese. Last year, they were only 33%. This is a 3rd and 5. Orgeron, he can scramble. Hits the edge. Has the first down. Cody Orgeron does it with his legs.
Boy, what a weapon. They ran the cross in the middle. Everybody was manned up, but Orgeron able to note it and decided to tuck it and run with it. Only had 5 yards to get. Found the sideline and moved the sticks. That is a weapon that they'll be using all year.
And Orgeron goes right to the air. Quick hitter to the end zone. Lots of contact, and there's the flag. Intended for Josh Matthews, the transfer out of Louisiana Tech, and Devin Hafford. It's going to be whistled for the foul.
Yeah, he's the X. He's the starting X. That Matthews with the outside release. Devin Hafford, the best cornerback that they have. One of the best in the Lone Star Conference last year. So good. But he ended up getting beat. Never did turn around for the ball and just too much contact.
Pass interference puts it in great scoring position for McNeese, all the way down at the 7-yard line of Tarleton State. First drive for McNeese State under their new head coach, Frank Wilson. And boy, have he and the Cowboys had to fight through a lot this offseason just to get on the field, as their athletic director called it, a minor miracle after COVID and the 2 hurricanes.
Yeah, the thing is, you watch them, it doesn't look like it. They come out on their opening drive, and while they might not be in midseason form, they've been doing a really good job. I've been impressed with Cody Orgeron's ability to manage this first drive with all that they've had to endure and the cold weather.
First and goal, McMahon to the right of Orgeron. And instead, Orgeron's going to keep it down to the 5-yard line, where he's snowed under by Wilson and company.
First time we've seen the RPO. Trey Johnson that time, the nickel, did a good job of staying home and reading that from the get-go. They had the receiver to the right lined up, man coverage, great coverage there. Really good job defensively by Tarleton to set up second and goal.
This drive starting at their own 36 for McNeese. First points of the spring, not yet. Deontay McMahon is stopped. Tries to keep churning, but it's forward progress, eliminated at the three by Chadwick Thibodeau.
Boy, you got to keep flowing to the football when you're facing a guy like Deontay McMahon. He just keeps those feet running, runs those feet, and he's not down until he's down. And good job by the safety to come down and get in the box and make that hit. But third down and three, Tarleton stiffening here.
Another big third down on this drive as McNeese tries to strike first in Stephenville. Orgeron to the air. Has a man, but it's right through the hands of Pettigrew. Watch the flag, though.
Boy, and Pettigrew got loose, and somebody missed an assignment, and that ball went right through his hands. Pettigrew, a guy that played at LSU when they ended up winning the 19 LSU National Championship.
Pettigrew playing every game of that historic season for the Tigers. And for Cody Orgeron's dad. Couldn't make the connection here, though. We'll see who this is on. Big, big call. Could this possibly be offensive pass interference? As you see Vidal Jones, the referee, having a little trouble with that mic. And on a cold night, that's not when you want to have the extra delays, for sure.
Pass interference, number 83, offense. It's declined, fourth down.
All right, so Trevor Begge picks up the offensive pass interference penalty.
Maybe get a second chance to watch this. They had everybody manned up, and you see that the outside backer kind of spying Orgeron that time. Did a real good job of that, Harris, and it just went right through Pettigrew's hands. Doesn't matter, though. This is going to be declined, and it sets up the field goal.
21-yard try from Jacob Abel, who was 13 for 13 last season at Butler Community College. Chip shot here. With the wind behind him, and Abel puts McNeese on the board. Nice opening drive for the Cowboys. Frank Wilson has to be excited about that. McNeese leads Tarleton early on. Stick with us from Stephenville here on Fox Sports Southwest. Opener in Stephenville, Texas. McNeese leading Tarleton 3-0 after the 21-yard Jacob Abel field goal. Let's take a look at the scoring drive. A really nice march, Scott.
Really nice. 12 plays, 61 yards. It takes about 4.5 minutes. Tarleton doing a good job of holding in the red zone. One of the problems McNeese had last year was putting the ball in the end zone when they got into the red zone. They had 44 chances last year to score touchdowns in the red zone. Only scored touchdowns on 19 of those possessions. That's less than 50%. It's one of the things they wanted to work on coming into the season.
And early on, they do get points, but not the six they wanted. Another chance for Kalen Horton. Horton, a dangerous return man. Lots of speed and hits the edge. Horton with good field position. Out to the 33-yard line. That's where Tarleton starts their second drive.
Really nice cut right there. You know, this Tarleton offense has only snapped it three times. They would certainly love to answer that long McNeese drive. You don't want to get into a situation where you've only got 8-10 snaps in a half. They need to string at least a couple of first downs together on this drive.
Steven Duncan, the new quarterback, going 1 of 2 in his time on the field. First time around, a 3 and out for Tarleton State. Khalil Banks still the running back for Tarleton. The ball out at the 33-yard line. Texans really excited to see what they can do against Division I competition this spring. Duncan goes play action on first down. Again, a lot of cushion for Bitson. Bitson forced out by Andre Sam, not before he gains 8 yards.
Got it, Sam, a couple of times already. Again, the converted safety, now cornerback. Tariq Bitson is the number two wide receiver, a little bit smaller, but he caught 63 balls last year.
D2 All-American at Adams State. That's a first down for Khalil Banks, slicing off the right side for a pickup of about three. Dorian Pollard, the middle linebacker, in on the stop.
Good job of moving the sticks for the first time. You know, as fast as McNeese played, Tarleton going a little bit faster here on this drive.
Yeah, no looking to the sideline for Tarleton here. Stephen Duncan pulls it down. Shows he's got a few wheels. An awkward tackle for a pickup of three. Darius Daniels knocks him off his pins.
Yeah, Duncan looking for the quick pass to that number two inside slot receiver, J.F. Thomas. He was covered up right there, being pressed by Ridge Tejada, number 19 on that defensive unit. You see him. He's a guy that has some football lineage. He's really smart.
McNeese showing blitz. This time they are offsides. A shot play up the sideline, and it's knocked away from Bitson. Andre Sam makes the play, but it was a free one for Stephen Duncan in the offense.
Yeah, showed the blitz right off the bat, and I'm a little bit surprised that they didn't time that a little bit better. Didn't really try to disguise it, and when you don't disguise it, a lot of guys, you don't see them jump offside like that.
Remain second down.
And way too early to try to time the snap count. That was only, the fifth snap we've seen out of Tarleton.
And for McNeese, they're playing basically without a defensive coordinator. Their defensive coordinator,
yep,
Grady Brown, left about a week ago to become the cornerback coach at Houston. That has got to be tough.
What I find interesting is they're not going to replace him right now. They feel like if they bring in a defensive coordinator at this point in this spring season, it would just muddy the waters a little bit too much. They're going to let some assistant coaches and some GAs kind of fill that role.
Tarleton across midfield for the first time. The slant route just over the head of J.F. Thomas. And Sam, again, there on the defense. You're right, they're really going after Andre Sam early on. But get a look at J.F. Thomas there. And there's Sam as well. That should be a great matchup. Thomas, who is picked by some to be an All-American this season at the FCS level after,
yep,
a really good D2 year last year.
Well, he's long, he's explosive, he's been looked at by a number of NFL scouts. He's really, really physical, too, at that wide receiver spot.
Third down, it is dropped by Duncan, and Duncan's in jail. The timing of that play got thrown all off by the mesh. Cameron Peterson chops him down, and punting time for Tarleton.
Yeah, bad snap right there. Just a mishandled snap there by Duncan. And I can't help but wonder if maybe the conditions might be getting to him a little bit. But for whatever reason, Duncan just has not been able to settle in the first two drives.
A few early jitters for the Western Kentucky transfer. Pretty good punt by Jake Walrath the first time around. Walrath trying to pin McNeese deep. Hangs it in the air into the wind. Fair catch called for, but they're going to let it roll out in front. Mason Pierce has to scramble away from it. And it's picked up by Tavis Coleman for Tarleton. So McNeese gets another crack at it after a nice drive their first time around. 64 yards, ended in a chip shot field goal. Cody Orgeron and the McNeese offense did everything but put it into the purple end zone.
And Orgeron has come out, and even though McNeese is on the road, they've had to come up from Lake Charles. I was wondering if they could even make their way through Central Texas over to Stephenville. I believe they stayed in Temple last night, and that's still about 2 hours away from Stephenville. So they've had some adversity to overcome in addition to the stuff we talked about in the offseason with the two hurricanes and COVID and everything else. They've had some travel to overcome, but I tell you, I've been impressed with McNeese and Cody Orgeron and what they've been able to do early in this game.
Orgeron and Deontay McMahon in the backfield. They were both a big part of that first drive. They're midway through the first quarter. McNeese up by that field goal. Orgeron, the second-year starter, stepping up in the pocket. And there's just nobody home. And one receiver to that side, all covered up, no gain. Blake Heal is in there on the stop.
Yeah, really good coverage. They ended up going with a deep post right there to the outside receiver. Orgeron looked, and he was all covered up, so he had to keep it.
Orgeron, the second-year starter, started his career as a sixth-string walk-on, but improved rapidly. Now in his senior season, he can play this spring and then again in the fall as well.
You know, and he's gotten so much better at his pre-snap reads. and the post-snap reads as well, but his ability to think critically has really accelerated his learning.
Second and 10, goes up the sideline, underthrown and intercepted. Benji Franklin not able to bring it to the ground in one piece. Should have been intercepted. Looked like he had it in his hand, Scott.
Boy, what a great play by Benji Franklin, who had terrific positioning to the inside, trying to go to Josh Matthews up top. And as we take a look at it, you just can't play it any better than that. I just thought that Franklin would have that pick. You know, he had four interceptions last year.
Great ball skills. Third down and 10 as Tarleton starts to make some noise defensively. Orgeron successful on third downs on the first drive. Tries to do it with his legs, but just runs out of real estate. And Tarleton gets a stop as Jordan Wells chases Orgeron out.
Went to dime coverage that time, and really good job in the secondary of being in the right spot. Nobody home, and Orgeron had to use his feet. He did that on the first drive, but only had 5 yards to get. Was able to scramble for the first down last time he did that. Not so this time.
This cold night, Tarleton able to bottle up the McNeese Cowboys here early on. On to punt, Bailey Rayborn. His third year as the starting punter for McNeese. Also had the place-kicking duties in 2019. Waiting back deep, Kalen Horton. Horton looking for an opportunity. That went through his hands. Now a pile-up.
It looked like Tarleton was able to hop on it, but I'm not sure that they were able to secure it.
We'll see.
Wow.
It's going to be McNeese football. Kalen Horton fumbles it. It's recovered by the McNeese Cowboys, and the Cowboys are set up inside the red zone already with a 3-0 lead.
Boy, the kicking game has certainly turned the tide, if not in field position. But look at this. The ball, I thought, was going to be hopped on by Tarleton. It looked like for a moment they were going to be able to cover it, but McNeese has been really energetic going after these kicks. They have swarmed the football on a couple of punts, and they get to it. You could tell that the wind was carrying it, and I thought at the very last, oh, if he tries to catch that, it's going to be a big trouble, and it turned into me.
Trey Vondelstein, the deep snapper, able to jump on top of it, and the first big turning point in this game goes to McNeese. They're at the 15-yard line of Tarleton State after the deep snapper recovers the muffed punt.
And a huge break. And you just can't give an experienced team like this early breaks in a game, particularly when you're playing at home, you're in your first game. I know it's only 3-0, but McNeese has certainly had the momentum early.
It's Matthews in motion. Instead, a give to McMahon. McMahon piles into the line for just a couple. Deontay McMahon, coaches say he is just dynamic at 5'9", 180 pounds. Out of Frostproof, Florida, but transferred in from Butte College. And McMahon has just come in and ripped this starting running back spot away from an incumbent.
Yeah, this will be the 16th play already of the game. Tarleton has snapped it just 8 times. McNeese has really had the control. And remember, Tarleton won the opening toss and took the ball.
Great point. Up the sideline. Incomplete. A little bit of jostling, but no flag. Josh Matthews, the intended receiver. Devin Hafford playing the coverage very tight.
Matthews wanted the call, and I think Hafford is the one that got called for pass interference earlier in the quarter. That time, really good coverage. He's good. I've been impressed with the secondary play between the two teams to start. These two teams are very physical in the back end, and that's what you've got to have, especially when you're going up against a guy like Cody Orgeron, who threw it for almost 3,000 yards last year.
Moments ago, a turnover put McNeese at the 15-yard line. Now a 3rd and 8, trying to keep this drive alive.
Yeah, it's a big 3rd down. You can keep it a 1-score game if you get a stop here.
And before the play, stoppage on
time
the field.
Out. Yep.
McNeese takes their first charge timeout.
Timeout by McNeese. We'll take it too. Big 3rd down on the way with McNeese up on Tarleton. 3-0. Welcome back into Tarleton State. Tarleton's defense trying to make another big stand After a fumble recovery by McNeese, the Cowboys face a 3rd and 8, the 13-yard line of Tarleton.
Yeah, you muff a punt and give up the possession here inside the 20, and you get a stop. This would be big for the Texans.
Orgeron, single coverage to the right side, lofts it up. What a catch! Josh Matthews goes up to grab it, and McNeese goes up 9-0.
What, Matthews with tremendous separation right off the line of scrimmage, and Orgeron able to locate it. What a throw. He had the wind, and he knew if he could just get it close with the ability of Matthews, they were going to make that a touchdown, and they did.
Josh Matthews, the transfer out of Louisiana Tech, one of his first targets as a Cowboy, ends up in 6. McNeese State taking advantage of the short field thanks to the muffed punt by Kalen Horton. Cowboys with a good start in Stephenville as Abel makes the extra point. Josh Matthews never had a touchdown catch in Ruston, but he's got one today for McNeese.
Yeah, and you watch this. It was just a great release off the line of scrimmage. He just lobbed it up and put it in a great spot. You saw the defensive back able to get in there. That's the backup corner, Kalen Horton, the sophomore out of Houston. He was able to make up the ground, but that throw put where only the wide receiver could get it on an over-the-shoulder catch. Great job by Matthews, who has tremendous leaping ability, but didn't really need it there. He just stretches out and is able to haul it in. Nice catch.
Out of Baton Rouge, Dunham High School. McNeese really happy to have him. And we take a look at the scoring drive. It took just 3 plays and 15 yards to get in. That's the conversion that you were talking about, Scott, earlier on. Desperate to convert red zone opportunities into touchdowns, yep. And McNeese gets one.
You know, they get one, but it was all set up by a miscue. And Tarleton committing the egregious mistake of the muff punt there and giving a chance for the Cowboys to put it in the end zone. And now they've dug themselves a little bit of a hole. And the problem is there's still almost 6 minutes to go in the quarter, and Tarleton still going against this stiff, frigid wind.
There's Kalen Horton, who not only muffed the punt, but then he was also beat on the touchdown as well. And Horton try to make up for the miscue. Horton this time will bring it out from 2 yards deep. There's a little wedge set up for him. Horton up the sideline, showing off the speed out near the 40.
Boy, he has tremendous athletic ability. And what I love about him is when you watch him return kicks, he's fearless. You can't be scared back there. I thought for certain he was going to grab that ball and maybe take a knee, for the touchback. But he said, no, we're coming out. And he's had so much success throughout his career doing that. He's built up a ton of confidence in himself, and he's given
Offside.
Tarleton good field position.
Number 10 of the kicking team. 5-yard penalty is added to the end of the run. It's first down.
Means even better field position for Tarleton. Again, they're trying to find that spark, Scott.
Yep.
And the offense, led by Stephen Duncan, they had it out near midfield for a 3rd down on their last drive, but then it all went awry for them.
Well, Todd Whitten hoping that kick return can give him a little bit of a spark. We'll see what Steve Duncan has for us. He's been off to a slow start.
Duncan does have a rocket and completes this one against the sideline. Tariq Bitson is forced out by Andre Sam as he picks up 5.
Tariq Bitson, he's a grad transfer out of Adams State, 6'3", 205, smaller, not blazing speed, but such a great route runner, and you can see the separation that he was able to generate. That's a nice 6 yards on first down.
Tulsa kid, well-traveled, even started his career at Oklahoma State before he went to Adams State.
And you can see that. You can see the talent.
They'll give him 7 instead, right back to Bitson. And Bitson stepping away and down the sideline. Bitson with the big play, down near the 20.
And again, he's able to get away from Andre Sam, the best cornerback that McNeese has. What terrific athletic ability. You give him any space, and he can be explosive, and we see it there. What a nice play right there.
26 yards on the catch and run.
Nice turn inside, but able to break the tackle. And we mentioned he's not big, but he is strong.
at the 21-yard line. Duncan standing tall. Throws a jump ball and just throws it out of bounds. Looking for J.F. Thomas. Just had to get rid of that one.
That's great patience in the pocket right there, though, by Steve Duncan. Remember, this offensive line, somewhat makeshift. They've got three transfers there. Ernest at left tackle, the Oklahoma State transfer. Perry, the other tackle, the Northwestern State transfer. Nice pocket that time. First time we've seen Steve Duncan, the Tarleton quarterback, it really display that patience and that pocket presence.
Not rattled by having to hold on to it for a few more ticks. On second down, he pulls it back. Looks to run. Duncan, not wow. much there as Sam comes to pop him out of bounds.
Boy, talk about getting your bell rung on a 28-degree night. It feels like 13 out there, and he took a hit.
And it's just going to keep getting colder tonight. We are expecting blizzard-like conditions sometime tomorrow. Thankfully, it doesn't look like it's going to snow until after midnight.
Man, that is a hit. And he got snowed under, I guarantee it, around the sideline.
Duncan looking back to the sideline on third down as Tarleton tries not to waste this golden opportunity, their best of their three drives. To the air. Up top for Thomas. Too strong. Thomas can't bring it in near the sideline, and it's fourth down.
I love the mindset, though, by McNeese. They go press coverage field side, and they literally dare the Tarleton wide receivers to be able to run past the DBs. And J.F. Thomas with the foot speed to do it. The problem was ran out of space in the end zone.
And now an opportunity at a field goal. This is going to be a 38-yarder for Tarleton State to try to get on the board for the first time as a Division I program. Got a guy from just down the road handling the field goal opportunity here in Adrian Guzman. Guzman's kick on the way into the wind. That's a tough kick and good.
Into the wind. It feels like it's 13 outside. I've seen Acme bricks that were softer than that football. And I don't know how in the world he was able to convert. That was a beautiful kick.
Adrian Guzman coming on and getting the ball through the uprights. He's out of Temple. The freshman getting the surprise start today over Christian Hernandez, who was advertised as their place kicker today. How about that?
Yeah, nice kick right there by Guzman. Again, you mentioned that of Temple, Texas. Six plays, 33 yards, less than 2 minutes. And again, Tarleton on the board, but they would like to have a few more minutes expire here to get the win.
It shows some of their big play ability, though, on that drive. Not only the turn away from the defender by Tariq Bitson, they officially ruled that a 28-yard catch and run, but then also it was all set up, right, by the beautiful return from Kalen Horton.
Yeah, I thought Horton's return gave him a spark, and he mentioned that they needed to find the spark, and they did. And, you know, regardless of what happens in this game tonight, John, this has been something to behold here in Stephenville with this program, a longtime member of the Lone Star Conference, really being turned around by Coach Witten. Because you look at the Tarleton program, and when he took it over about 6 years ago, they were one of the worst defenses in the country. And now they've become one of the best. And that's what great coaches do. They're able to come in, turn it around, and Coach Witten does it old school. He starts with defense.
And also one of the best offenses as well over the last few years. The short kick brought in by Jacoby Skinner, who touches it for the first time. And Skinner out across the 30. Tumbles out to the 35-yard line, and that's where McNeese takes over. 3:32 left in this first quarter. Cowboys up 10-3. One nice long drive for a field goal, and then a doorstep opportunity for Orgeron to hit Josh Matthews for a 13-yard touchdown last time out. There you get a chance to look at Todd Witten, and you're exactly right. He's turned this program around, and he's prepared this team for the move from Division II to Division I, and it's something that he knows a lot about. He went from Division II, Tarleton, his second stint with Tarleton, up to Division I, taking the job at Sam Houston. It's never an easy transition to do, and We can talk about that as we go on. New running back, by the way, in Jacoby Skinner. But instead, a throw to the outside, and Jamal Pettigrew, the tight end, is upended nicely.
You talk about a physical play by a safety coming downhill. He was at full speed and turned Pettigrew around like a top and put him right in the turf. My gosh, look at this play right here. Pettigrew trying to make a move. Great tackle by Donovan Banks, who had an incredible year last year. Fast, physical, the Blinn Junior College transfer. Man.
Yeah, first-year starter for Marcus Patton's defense. Second down and 9. Skinner with the first carry. Nice cutback. First down and more all the way out to the 46. Devin Hafford makes the stop, but a rip of 14.
You watch Hayden Shaw, number 78 on that play, with just a terrific reach block there on the edge. Opened the way for Jacoby Skinner, the 5'9", 176-pound running back. You can't do it better than that. I can't believe that guy's a freshman.
Skinner, the biggest play of the first half so far, as that's going to be a penalty. Incomplete on the play. But Trey Johnson, maybe Ronnell Wilson there a little bit early on the slot receiver, Mason Pierce.
And one of the things that you notice when you watch not only the Tarleton secondary operate, but the McNeese secondary too, they're not afraid to get in there and lay a lick. They might get there a little bit early. They may gamble at times, and they'll give up some of those because it's about a mindset. It's about establishing your will in the secondary. You can't be scared. If he was there just a hair early, you saw that, no doubt a penalty, but you know, that may be a penalty 7 out of 10 times, but those 3 times it'll pay off for them.
Aggressive play by the nickel, Trey Johnson. Now you get a look at the slot receiver, Mason Pierce, a redshirt freshman, only goes a buck 45 out of Pearland, Texas. So a new set of downs for McNeese, across midfield at the 45. Orgeron under center for the first time. Rolling out, Skinner has a lot of space. Skinner dances his way to a first down.
They fake the fly sweep to freeze the backer, opened up the right side in the flat. Great play call. There's a flag out in the backfield here.
Catch and run is 17, and we're checking that flag.
Rookie the passer, probably, yep.
They get Eric Willis, the senior, fifth-year senior, out of Lawndale, California, for the extra penalty, and that's another half the distance to the goal. And now McNeese is right back where they were moments ago at the 14-yard line, trying to open up this lead.
I will say this, in watching McNeese, it doesn't look like this is the first year of a first-year head coach. Frank Wilson has come out. He has really coached this team up. They look very polished given what they've had to overcome.
Double tight ends. Another little waggle for Orgeron. Throws to the end zone. Incomplete. Intended on that crosser for Mason Pierce. Trey Johnson on the coverage.
Yeah, and I love how K.J. Brown, who is the tight end working on the right side that time, ended up getting chucked right there. He ended up getting hammered right off the line of scrimmage and rerouted, which sort of blew that play up. And great coverage on the back end there in the end zone by Tarleton. Tarleton's doing a good job, but McNeese has gotten into the red zone of tightening up and toughening up.
Along with Scott Garner, I'm John Little from Stephenville, Texas. McNeese out of the Southland Conference playing FCS Independent Tarleton. Second down for Orgeron. Flush from the pocket. Orgeron down the sideline. Scoots out of bounds for a pickup of 4. 3rd and 6 coming up. Chadwick Thibodeau made sure Orgeron didn't pick up the first.
Yeah, and he had nobody to throw to unless he wanted to really throw back across the field. I can't imagine that that wasn't a busted play of sorts. That did not look like a midseason play. Tarleton all over it, but you see the speed of Orgeron still able to pick up a few yards with it.
A really sneaky good athlete.
Yeah.
At 175 pounds and 6'1".
And coaches have said, he doesn't look that fast on tape. You get him down on the field, and it's almost like you can't believe he's that fast.
On third down, they go to the ground, and burrowing for yardage inside the 10, and a little extracurricular after Skinner is short of the first down.
You know, in a play call like that, John, would lead you to believe that McNeese wanted to go for it. They were thinking about going for it on fourth down. We'll see what they do. I don't see anybody coming. It looks like they may want to go. Well, they may be making a change here. We'll see.
Yeah, really late to make a change, but it does look like the field goal unit, or at least some bigger players are coming on. You're exactly right, Scott. They're going to bring on the tight ends and the fullbacks, and
they're going to call a timeout here. The timing of that personnel exchange was not good.
Well, a 4-yard pickup for Skinner. It's going to leave a fourth down and two here. And hey, why not if you're McNeese? You're already leading 10-3. You've shown that you can do a pretty good job stopping Tarleton so far. Why not try to punch it in?
Well, you know, McNeese, they feel like they've got things under control. They're up by 7. It feels like a bigger lead than that, only because Tarleton's had some problems offensively, and McNeese, they've come out, they've made some plays. This is a club, as we talked about early, that wants to try to work on putting the ball in the end zone here. They settled for a lot of field goals last year in the red zone.
Like you said, Frank Wilson is a first-year head coach. Yeah. But think about this. They have they've had a long time to get used to him as the head coach, but they weren't able to really practice like other teams in the fall. So the point you made earlier on about, can't believe this is under a first-year head coach, I absolutely agree with you, because it's amazing how clean they've been. Fourth down and 2 here. McNeese going for it. A pitch out to Skinner, but Tarleton strings it out. Devin Happer changed that play, and the Texans take over.
Boy, they tried to load up, and Devin Happer coming up and showing you why he not only is a great cover corner, but one of the more physical corners that they've seen in the Lone Star Conference in a while. What a play. Happer gets in there immediately as they run the old student body toss sweep into the boundary. I'm surprised they went to that play, given the fact that they kind of gave that away with that jumbo package before the timeout.
And maybe that's the spark that Tarleton needed to get things going, down by 7 nearing the end of the first quarter on a cold night in Stephenville. Stephen Duncan back out there for his fourth possession. And on first down, just nothing doing for the new running back. And that's going to be Braylon Bridges out of Houston, a true freshman getting a carry for the first time in his career.
Yeah, and we knew that both of these two teams were deep at the running back position, and they wanted to get some guys in, not just late in the game, but kind of shuffle them in earlier.
On second down, Duncan goes up top. This time, he has the J.F. Thomas connection. Thomas, a big catch, 19 and a first down.
That's a great route run right there by Thomas. Small window. Andre Sam, not bad coverage. Wasn't great coverage on the quick slant. Great timing between Duncan and J.F. Thomas.
Maybe another one or two plays before the end of the quarter for the purple and white. And another handoff to the freshman. To the outside, Braylon Bridges nears a first down. He's a yard short, pickup of 9. And depending on the spot, they're going to move those chains. 10 yards for Braylon Bridges.
Houston Klein Collins High School. 5'10", 180 pounds. You saw him put his foot in the ground and bounce it, and he got there to the sideline in a hurry.
Looks like the last play of the first quarter. Duncan not afraid to go up top. Down the sideline, and a flag flies. Looking for Gabe Douglas. Colby Richardson with a lot of contact. And that may give Tarleton great field position heading into the second quarter.
Might be an untimed down here if this goes against McNeese. Might be a defensive hold. I saw some pushing and shoving before the ball was thrown.
And our referee, Vidal Jones. You're exactly right, an untimed down here to end the first quarter for Tarleton State. So this is exactly what the Texans needed, that big shot of a stop on fourth down. Now they're starting to get the offense humming.
You know, it, again, they've had to go against the wind for 15 minutes. And run another play. We haven't done it long enough against the wind. Do it one more time.
Fake handoff. throw up the seam, incomplete for J.F. Thomas. Not much separation, and that will bring an end to the first quarter. An entertaining first quarter for the McNeese State Cowboys as Josh Matthews scores his first touchdown in a McNeese uniform. The Cowboys coming to Stephenville and leading early on. Don't go anywhere. The second quarter is next. 10-3, McNeese on top. You're looking at the brand new press box here at Tarleton Memorial Stadium, just opened up last year. It's a cold night as we start the second quarter here in Stephenville. Tarleton on the march trying to get this game tied up. Stephen Duncan rolls out, throws it up the sideline for Gabe Douglas. More contact.
Golly, I can't believe how physical it is when the ball is in the air between wide receivers and DBs in this game. That time, I thought Richardson, he was jostling, but at the same time, you know, the wide receiver, I thought he may have done more. Douglas may have done more pushing than the DB.
And maybe a good no call.
Yeah, I thought it was a great no call.
Richardson was the one that was flagged earlier on this drive to get it into McNeese territory. Tarleton, as they're moving left to right, does have the wind behind them, and the wind is not insignificant this evening. 12-13 miles an hour out of the north.
And it may take a throw or two for Steve Duncan, the Tarleton quarterback, to get used to throwing with the wind now that he's been going against this stiff, cold wind. But this is a big play in this game. It's third down and 10 on the 45. It's still a one-possession game. You'd love to convert this.
Colby Richardson coming out of the game. That cornerback spot for McNeese that they replace him with Chris Joyce, a transfer out of Tulane.
You know, he was hurt early last year.
Here's third and 10 for Duncan.
Look out.
Backside pressure and slipping coming out of his break is Gabe Douglas. They went right after Chris Joyce, but that one is a miscommunication between Douglas and Duncan, and the punting unit comes on for Tarleton.
Yeah, and that's the first time we've seen Duncan take an absolute smash on the backside as Leighton Ernst, that left tackle, had a hard time mirroring that defensive end, and Duncan taking quite a hit.
Stephen Duncan so far in this one, 6 of 12 through the air for 60 yards. On to punt, Jake Walrath. This time with the wind behind him. Gets it away. Mason Pierce waiting back. Calls for the fair catch and makes it at the 6-yard line. Tarleton will take that. McNeese up by a 10-3 score.
When you look at this, just a blow right there. First time we have seen that. That was Mason Kinsey. A transfer from the Citadel, one of three defensive linemen that McNeese has that start, that did not start their career here. They've had a ton of transfers, and it's the defensive line that lost all four starters last year, and they're hoping that these transfers can help.
Isaiah Chambers bookends the other side. They're really excited about him as well. But they love this kid, Cody Ogeron, thrown a touchdown in this one after 24 touchdown tosses last year.
Boy, what a great kick right there to force McNeese to start inside their own 10.
Worst starting field position by far for the Cowboys. And a give to Skinner, who showed a lot on that last drive, and Skinner is able to pick up 4 right up the teeth of the Texans defense.
Been really impressed with McNeese. This Cowboy offensive line, they don't do a lot of power encounter. They do a lot of inside zone stuff with their RPO game, but the center, Whitehead, a lot of experience coming back. Their big leader, though, is Kendall Dirt, their left guard. He's the guy on the offensive line that really helps them out.
10-3 advantage for McNeese, trying to get out of their own end. Ogeron on the straight quarterback draw, trying to pop through the other side, and he has close to a first down, but he falls down at the 16-yard line, just shy of it. Leaves a third down 1.
Quarterback power right there all the way. Coleman, the left guard, the junior transfer out of Coffeyville College. 6'2", 300-pounder. Good job.
McNeese going quickly. Skinner running tough for a first down. Needed 1, picked up 4. The Cowboys moving into the wind may rely a little bit more on that running game.
Yeah,
the running game's been good.
Frank Wilson had mentioned that they may do a little bit more running tonight than what you normally might see, especially they've got the 7-point lead here deep in their own territory against the wind for the first time. You see Coach Wilson there, 4 years as the head coach at UTSA after a nice stint as the running backs coach at LSU, and that's sort of how he built the relationship of getting Pettigrew the tight end.
Orgeron is blasted as he got rid of that one somehow to Dante Hargrove. Tarleton covers that one up for a loss of one. Josh Kemp making the stop.
Really nice open field tackle, and we've seen Tarleton do a good job of that. And that's what this Tarleton defense is about. It's about simplicity.
Illegal shift
by the offense. Two players in motion. Number six of the offense never reset before the snap. Penalty is declined. Second down.
So they take a loss of one instead of making it first down 15.
But Marcus Patton is the defensive coordinator for the Texans. And the one thing that they changed when Coach Witten took it over about 5 or 6 years ago was taking a lot of the complex stuff out of what they do. They want to try to keep it simple, be good at what they do, don't expand it too much, and get players thinking rather than reading and reacting and playing downhill.
On this play, Orgeron gives it off, but there is just nothing on the inside of that Tarleton line. Skinner goes down for no gain. And what they say, what Patton says is, his key is pretty simple. Tackle, be tough, and fly around. Other than that, yeah, keep it simple.
And that's what this game goes back to, blocking and tackling. You can X's and O's it all you want, but those teams that can block and those teams that can tackle are the best teams. And you've seen Tarleton tonight make some great one-on-one tackles. I love how they're flowing to the football.
Here's third down. Orgeron, little happy feet. Has a man over the middle, but it is dropped. Incomplete. Josh Matthews had it in his hands, but it falls to the turf. Would have been good for a first down. What a throw by Orgeron.
Well, and it looked like Matthews trying to catch that ball with his body rather than his hands. That ball should have been caught. But I'll tell you what, the ability to extend plays like Orgeron has, he had a chance to make a play there. And again, you see the ball getting in too tight to the wide receiver. Instead of getting those hands out, he tried to cup it against his body, and Matthews just could not make the grab.
Hit Matthews right on the six. And Tarleton, it's another big stop. Tries to keep field position in their favor. Punt by Bailey Rayborn into the wind here. Horton is back deep. Says get away from it. Remember, he muffed one earlier. This one rolls to the 43-yard line. Not a bad punt into a pretty stiff breeze.
And we have not seen a 40-yard punt going from right to left as we see it. When you're going against that wind, it's just almost impossible tonight.
McNeese holding on to a 7-point lead in Stephenville. First Division I game for Tarleton. Under 12 to play in the second. Welcome back in. Always have a good contingent of the military, the ROTC, that show up to games here at Memorial Stadium. McNeese with a 10-3 advantage. But this has been a long road upward for Tarleton to get from Division II to Division I. Stephen Duncan on the sideline. We heard that they wanted to get Cameron Burston into the game, the senior. And Burston is in there to lead this drive. No lying by the head coach as he hits J.F. Thomas with his first pass, a pickup of four.
Burston, the senior, with great relationships with all of these guys. He's been in the system a while. And Vallejo, California, knows the system, and he's got a strong arm.
Here's the thing about Burston. He needs this opportunity because he can't play in the fall. He is out of semesters this spring. They wanted to get him in. So Burston back to the air. Up the right sideline. It's bobbled and dropped. Tariq Boston had it fall through, but Richardson never gave up and made it just tough enough on Bitson.
Yeah, Richardson's back after he got hurt earlier. He tweaked a leg earlier, but he's back in there. Made a nice play there. Your vocal leader in that secondary and able to make up the ground just enough to try to break that pass up at the very last. Bitson had his hands on it, though.
Absolutely. Richardson just not giving up. And you see, just after one play, Bitson has to come out.
And Ells receiver downfield on the pass. Number 61 of the offense. It's a 5-yard penalty. Second down.
So
Javion Chambers, the right guard that ended up getting downfield.
So even if that pass was completed, it would not have counted. Javion Chambers is a pretty fun story. 5'9", 300 pounds, not the prototypical D1 size. Scott.
Right. No, yeah, he's only 6 feet. They list him at six feet. 5'9", 285. Doesn't have, you know, you like linemen that have the long reach. He doesn't have that, but boy, he's got a high motor, 4-year starter on this team.
Oh, they love the kid. Second down and 11. Right back to the air, taking the shot play and just incomplete over that left hand of J.F. Thomas. Man, these one-on-one coverage opportunities by the corners have been really good. As you take a look at Cameron Burston, he was the backup last year to Ben Holmes and got into six games.
He did. You see that they're using him a lot of timing routes from the get-go, a lot of quick passes, quick throws, not a lot of decision-making right here, and just trying to see if Burston can hit the home run.
Third down, 11. As Tarleton tries to pick up a first down on this drive. Burston to put it in the air again, testing the wheels. Against the sideline, it's intercepted. Rich Tejada picking it off. Rich Tejada with the interception. The freshman steps in front of that pass. There is a flag down as well, but for now, McNeese has the football after the interception by the freshman.
Boy, and we mentioned that Burston had not really had to make any decisions. That time he ended up rolling, had to make a decision, and
personal
made
foul.
An egregious mistake.
Roughing the passer. Number 40, defense. 15 yards from the previous spot. It's automatic first down.
Boy, that's Isaiah Chambers. That's your defensive end, that star-studded end, the grad transfer out of the University of Houston, who saw a lot of time in the American Conference. Just a shove there after Burston had let that ball go. And he wasn't finished.
No, he wanted to go block after the interception was thrown. So the Rich Tejada interception is wiped off the board. Tarleton moves the chains.
Well, that's a break, too.
Huge break. Because it really didn't affect the play at all as the handoff goes to Braylon Bridges. And how about Braylon Bridges? The freshman wasn't even on the depth chart coming into this one, but he's being trusted as the number two back in today's game.
Yeah, and Bridges, he's got a lot of talent, a guy that has really worked his way into getting this time, and we'll see how he finishes up after week one.
Second down. Quick toss to the flat. Roberson, Dre Roberson, he's got the quickness. And Roberson picks up 7 on the play. Sam and McCoy combine on the stop.
When Richardson came downhill, and he was the guy that got there first, that cornerback, but Roberson was able to shake him, and he's got great hands. But what about the explosiveness? He was able to make the move and then get vertical in a hurry. Great quickness right there by Dre Roberson.
Here's 3rd and 3, following his blockers nicely. Bridges breaks out. Bridges inside the 10, but he fumbles. And coming out with it is Corey McCoy. What a break for McNeese.
Break for McNeese. A mistake in the red zone. The flag came out, maybe for a crackback block, a blindside block. We'll see after the turnover. But, man, ball security is so important, particularly on a night like tonight when it's cold.
You said it, Scott. It feels like it's in the teens out there, and that one gets punched away from the freshman. Checking the flag, but does look like it might be post-possession. Lydell Jones has been busy.
Throwing is a fumble covered by the defense. Nearing the return, it's a personal foul for a legal blindside block by number 1 of the defense. It's half distance to the goal from the spot of the foul. It's first down.
And Tarleton's good drive gets thrown off by the fumble.
Yeah, it was a great run right there by the youngster. Look at the patience behind the block, but just did not have it high and tight, lost the ball. McNeese ends up taking it over.
The Tarleton State Band in attendance, of course, here in Stephenville, braving the tough night. Fumble recovery made by Corey McCoy there to give it back to McNeese after the Texans were driving. McNeese State with a 10-3 advantage. And starting off with the ground game, again, moving into the wind. And The ground has been pretty kind to McNeese in this one.
Has been. Again, it starts with that offensive line, and it's anchored by Max Schreit on that left tackle position and Caron Coleman at left guard. Big, strong tackles and guards. They've got big linemen, and they've got terrific push.
Deep backfield as well. A.J. Carter, a transfer from Arizona State, with his first carry. And Carter bobbles it. Did he actually hold on to that football somehow for a two-yard pickup? Looks like he did, out to the 15. And Tarleton.
This might be Texan ball here.
They are saying they think it is. But I didn't see the officials rule that way. It looks like it's third down.
Love to get a replay of this. The initial bobble. We've seen some bobbles. We've seen some drops that you don't ordinarily see. But again, we've got out of the ordinary conditions tonight with temperatures in the 20s.
Oh, wow.
High and tight. It usually doesn't mean against your helmet.
Taking that a little too literally there, yeah. Young man. So third down and 5 for McNeese. Cody Ogeron's going the whole way at quarterback. Started from last year. Ogeron with a lot of time, and he can do a lot of this. Ogeron finds the edge in a first down. Just when you thought he had been cut off, Ogeron gallops for 8 and a new set of downs.
Boy, and Ogeron quickly becoming the leading rusher on this team here in this game with that scamper. What a nice job by Cody Ogeron. We've seen him run for a first down. He almost did it twice on a scramble. That time he does move the sticks.
7 carries for 32. They give him 9 out to the 24-yard line. He scored first on a two-shot field goal, added to it with a touchdown toss to Josh Matthews. Tarleton fought back with a field goal of their own, only scoring in the first quarter here in Stephenville. And another opportunity for A.J. Carter. This time Carter with a little better handle on it. Rumbles for 6, D.J. Harris in on the stop.
It's a nice wham play as the H-back comes over to get the end, but I love watching Nick Holiday work at that right tackle position, number 79, the sophomore, 6'5", 320. Really blocks well through the echo of the whistle. Does a really nice job. This offensive line, you can tell they've worked a lot with the sled because they put screws to screws, and they just keep going until they hear that whistle.
Stoppage on the field for an injury as you see Eric Willis, the fifth-year senior defensive end, trying to get off the field. They had to stop it for him for a moment. Willis trying to jump off whatever that was.
Willis, a guy that had a great year last year, an overachiever, a walk-on, big motor, 6'3", 225, out of Lawndale, California. They don't want to miss him.
Second and 4, another give to A.J. Carter, just plunging forward for 3. Third down and 1 coming up.
See McNeese trying to control the ground game. They've run it more effectively tonight. They are over 90 yards on the ground. Tarleton has rushed it for just 40 in this game, and they really felt like the ground game would be the difference.
They're going right back to it, and to pick up the first down, A.J. Carter stumbles for a pickup of 2. You know, Carter, a good story. 6 feet tall, 218. He's going to come out here, but he's out of Louisiana. Small town, many Louisiana. Went to Arizona State for the first couple years, but transferring back to McNeese and helping bolster that backfield.
You know, obviously, with the transfer portal becoming so popular at the Division I level, you see a lot of transfers in every program. But, you know, with COVID taking hold of the country and the NCAA coming out with the edict that, you know, players can come back next year even if they've run out of time, makes it tough for high school seniors to find a spot.
Teyonte McMahon grabs the toss, but then Byron Broussard grabs him, the first year starter, transfer from Abilene Christian, with the tackle.
Yeah, they try to get it on the edge. They've had some success with that. Teyonte McMahon, the Butte College transfer, being really denied a big play as they just kind of forced him to the sideline.
It's a 4-yard pickup. Ogeron to the air here. Ogeron makes you defend the whole field as he runs sideline to sideline. Just chucks it away. Third down.
Yeah, Deion Cormier, the intended target, I guess. They had 3 guys around him. Tarleton's done a good job of covering in the secondary for the most part tonight. really limiting Orgeron. I know he's your leading rusher for McNeese, but they've limited him somewhat. You look at what he's done through the air, just 4 of 11, 48 yards. This Tarleton defense has covered well. They've got three guys that are transfers in that play a lot. Banks and Broussard at safety, I think, have done a good job tonight, too.
Third down again. Orgeron sees some late pressure. Uses that ball fake well, but he rolls forward just shy of the first down. Only picked up three when he needed six. Should be punting time here as Byron Broussard makes his second tackle of this series.
And I thought Zach Hopkins probably made that play because he set the edge. He forced Orgeron back inside, whereas a lot of times you see guys get a little too aggressive. Defensive ends lose contain. That time Hopkins didn't, and he made Orgeron scamper to the middle of the field into the teeth of that defense to force the punt.
Tarleton defense has done a nice job of not letting this game get away when there have been turnovers.
No question about it.
Bailey Rayborn on to punt again, and this time into the wind. This is not a good one off the side of his foot, but it's going to take a nice little roll. It runs into one of his own guys at the 26, but Devin, or rather, that is Corey McCoy for McNeese picking it up. And Tarleton will have it back, trying to figure out a way to tie this game. Still 10-3, McNeese. A lot of spirit from the purple and white despite the score. Tarleton in their first game as an FCS independent, hanging around against Coach Wilson's McNeese Cowboys. Tarleton has it back with plenty of time to spare here late in the first half, but that is dropped. They're going to say it was down. Khalil Banks fumbling, but evidently after he was down by contact at the 29.
Yeah, we've seen a number of balls hit the carpet tonight that ordinarily, again, you would not see. Kind of a combination of it being the first game. These two teams haven't played a game in over a year. And we saw an old-fashioned power play there, and the ball just ended up getting mishandled.
Like a good call. Looked like it did come off the turf. Raheem Skinner is in as the running back now. As Stephen Duncan's back in at quarterback, goes to the air. A lot of jostling. Again, no call on the pass intended for J.F. Thomas, but there's no doubt Tarleton wanted a flag to come out. Third down.
That was a good no call that time. I thought Richardson did a really good job getting in position right there. You know, there's some hand fighting, and there has been both sides, both cornerbacks. Both sets of cornerbacks, defensive backs have established the physical play, and just can't throw a flag on every play, but that time, not a good no call.
A lot of shot plays for Tarleton in this one. They need another one on third and eight. Duncan facing five-man pressure, and there's a lot of contact again, but Thomas pulls it down and has the first down out to the 42. Wow, what a wrestling match between Richardson and Thomas tonight.
Unbelievable by the former basketball player, J.F. Thomas, who had Richardson all over him. The offensive line did a good job of picking up the pressure, and somehow Thomas is able to hold on with Richardson all over him. What a play.
We are right back to play. Duncan takes another shot down the right sideline looking for Tariq Bitson. Bitson brought it in but was forced out when he was in midair by the coach's son, Quad Wilson, the son of the head coach, Frank Wilson. Good headsy play by the freshman from San Antonio to prevent a big play.
Yeah, Bitson, a guy that likes to run a lot of drag routes, combo routes, things like that. And he's been a big part of the Tarleton package so far tonight.
Second down, and Duncan gives it to Skinner for the first time. Skinner finds some space out past the 45-yard line and near midfield. 6-yard carry. Masri Maypew, the transfer from Louisiana Lafayette, in on the stop.
What a great block by Kendall Durth, that junior from Atascosa, 6'9", 320, on Dorian Pollard on that kickout block on the linebacker. Really allowed that play to happen.
His dad, a Tarleton Hall of Famer, James Durth. In fact, he's on a poster outside the stadium. Huh. Third down, 4, throw out in the flat. That's a first down. And more for Roberson. Dre Roberson throwing on the brakes. Corey McCoy forces him out. A gain of 7 into McNeese territory.
Great pre-snap read by Duncan. They go zone coverage with some off coverage that time, but Steve Duncan able to find Roberson almost immediately. Great job off the play action pass.
Tarleton averaging 45 points a game over the last two seasons. Not a great start offensively today, but trying to crank it into gear. Another throw to that left side. J.F. Thomas pulls it in and has 7, maybe 8 yards down to the 37.
You know, Tarleton only gave up 14 sacks the whole year last year. Last two plays, though, some pressure being put on Duncan, and he's fortunate that they're running some hot routes and some quick routes that he can get the ball out quickly.
Second and 2. Duncan wants to take a shot. Up the left seam for Thomas again. And that one's just overthrown. They are really working that left side against Andre Sam. And it's 3rd down 2.
Yeah, and 3 straight plays. I mean, 3 straight plays. They have brought pressure. And that time Pollard came from the backside and got to Duncan. He had to let that thing go. Didn't really have a chance to step into it like he likes to. But Raheem Skinner, the running back, he's got to be able to pick up the blitz and keep pressure off of his quarterback, Duncan.
Big 3rd and 2, handoff to Skinner. He bursts for a first down, buries the head for 4. With 3 minutes left in the first half, Tarleton down by 7, but in a good position. The problem is, last time they were in this spot, there's a fumble, a big turnover that probably took points off the board.
Yeah, that was a great read option look. Looked like it was a straight give all the way anyway, but nice job by the offensive line to give Tarleton a new set of downs. We got a chance to tie this ball game going into the break.
New set of downs. Duncan faces pressure again, but finds Roberson in the flat with room to run. Roberson ranging for 8 yards down to the 25.
It's the first time they've gone a screen pass to the right side, just a quick pass on the edge to allow the other wide receiver to be a blocker. And that time Tarleton takes advantage of the off coverage near side.
And on 2nd down, a give to Skinner. Skinner finds a place to cut and picks up the first. I tell you, the play calling is starting to really get into groove for Tarleton.
Yeah, and he's small, but he's thick. And I just thought he made a great read right there, reading the defense and a great cut. Skinner able to pick up a few extra to move the sticks.
Tarleton ready to go again. Skinner ready to carry it again. Inside the 20-yard line. Goes for another 4 yards as we hit the 2-minute mark of the first half.
Yeah, the one thing that you notice, kind of a common denominator among Banks and Skinner and the other backs, is the fact that they keep their feet moving. They might get hit, but it's going to take more than one defensive player to bring them down.
Running back by committee continues. The freshman Braylon Bridges is in for Skinner on 2nd down. Duncan goes to Bridges. Bridges! Oh, he was a step away from taking it to the house, but it's 1st and goal, the tackle made by Cordell Williams.
They run that wham play, but they bring the H back, and it was a good box to run against, that nickel coverage, that nickel formation, and Tarleton taking big-time advantage of it, and now McNeese wants to call a timeout to talk about things.
Yeah, there's no doubt. This isn't a time-saving timeout, Scott. This is try not to let them score timeout. Timeout on the field, we take it to with McNeese up on Tarleton by 7. Here, McNeese head coach Frank Wilson trying to edge his defense to keep Tarleton out of the end zone. He's up 10-3 on Tarleton with a minute and a half to play here in the first half. John Biddle back with Scott Garner. And as Tarleton's really gotten it going, and they're looking for their first touchdown in their Division I history, where do you think they go for offense?
Well, we'll see, but this is the 13th play of this drive coming up, by far the longest of the game.
A lot of success with the ground game. And here's Skinner on the cutback. Raheem Skinner closer to Painter, down to the 3.
And Zach Perry, who is a Division I transfer at Northwestern State in that right tackle spot, big number 73, the Arlington Heights product, doing an amazing job on the longest drive of the game, their best drive.
Skinner, big cutback. He's got the score. And the Tarleton Texans have scored a touchdown for the first time as a Division I program.
by far the best this Texan offense has looked. Tremendous rhythm, tremendous timing, a great job by Duncan to manage the offense, but most importantly, they got tremendous production out of the offensive line. At that time, the tight end Sloan Selman with a terrific block there right in front of just a terrific run.
Christian Hernandez tries to tie it up, and he does. We're deadlocked at 10 apiece after a grinding drive by the Tarleton Texans. It took them a long time to get going in this game offensively, Scott. They get something going and get knocked back. Get something going, but finally the ground game gets it done.
What about Rodney Clemens? Clemens, 6'4", 225-pound sophomore out of Quartz Hill, California. A terrific run by Raheem Skinner. And obviously a guy that runs hard, he's small, he's thick, but he's a one-cut guy. He doesn't dance, he doesn't try to bounce when he shouldn't. And that time, it was about the offensive line and the ground game to get this ball game tied. It's really what Tarleton was trying to do earlier in the game. They just couldn't quite find the rhythm.
15 plays, 73 yards, a lot of it on the ground for Tarleton State. Raheem Skinner, who had three touchdowns on the ground last season, his first year in a purple uniform, gets the honors to break the seal here in the spring of 2021. And again, yeah, we're playing live 6 days after the Super Bowl. We've got more football for you this year.
Yeah, and you see head coach Todd Whitten talking to Gabe Douglas right there. But one of the things that Coach Whitten had mentioned coming in is the fact that over the course of the last 5 to 6 years, in his third stint as the head coach of this Texan program, just the toughness and getting this team ready to go week in and week out. This is a team that they won every regular season game the last 2 years. And it's hard to do. It's hard to go from one of the worst teams defensively to one of the best. One of the ways he does it is every day in practice, putting the good guys against the good. He calls it good on good. They run their top guys against their top guys. They might have an injury or two throughout the season doing that, but it really helps the toughness.
Mason Pierce takes it out from the 5-yard line and runs into a purple wall right around the 24. And that's where McNeese State takes over. 59 seconds to play in the half. McNeese has spent their timeouts, so it's going to be interesting to see if Frank Wilson puts the pedal to the metal offensively or not here in a tie ball game going into the win.
Ordinarily, in a tie ball game, you've got a minute left. And you're a team that's not afraid to throw the ball. You've got a quarterback who can run. It would be a time to try to let's take a chance the first play or two. I would be surprised if they did that. I would not be shocked to see this ball handed off and to see both of these two teams go into the locker room in a hurry.
Cody Ogeron, the senior quarterback for McNeese. We understand his dad, Ed Ogeron, the head coach of LSU, the national champion, is here in Stephenville tonight as well. Anybody who's anybody in football is here in Stephenville tonight, because this is where the college football is happening.
This is the only game going on at FCS right now. And, you know, John, it's amazing. You know, you walk around Stephenville before the game, and there's just a buzz about it, even with this weather that we've got, with the blizzard conditions on the horizon. This town talking about Tarleton State football going Division I and continuing the success that they've built the last several years.
Delay of game makes it a first and 15. No time off the clock, but more running for A.J. Carter. He has been a tough runner since coming on. Carter gets the penalty yardage back and more, bursting out for an 8-yard gain on first down. But the clock runs, and once again, McNeese has no timeouts.
Yeah, McNeese, after they got that 21-yard touchdown from Orgeron to Matthews to take the 10-0 lead, they've given up 10 points straight. But also, they've gone turnover on downs, punt, punt. They've done really virtually nothing against this Texan defense that's really stiffened after digging themselves the early hole.
Touchdown came on a short drive after a fumble, a muffed punt.
Yep.
A.J. Carter cutting off the line, and Carter rolls forward close for a first down with only 12 seconds to play in the first half. Carter hustles back up. He wants another shot at the end of the first half, but it looks like The veteran head coach, Frank Wilson, is going to be content with taking a tie on the road to the break. We are bundled up tightly here in Stephenville tonight. A 25-degree evening. And the score is bundled up as well here at halftime. 10-10 our score. McNeese and Tarleton, after two quarters, nothing decided in this first FCS game of the year. Stick with us on Fox Sports Southwest. We've got more college football coming up. Cozy Stephenville, Texas is the place to be tonight. Welcome back into the first FCS game of the spring season in 2021. In fact, it's the first game college football in the spring since the 90s. The 1890s.
The 1890s. John, that's going back a long way.
Yeah, I know. John Littlebeck with good to have you with us with Scott here. And Scott, tell me about this first half, because, you know, it's just been a great transition to Division I for this Tarleton team to get on the scoreboard. But you see, they made the jump to the NCAA Division I in July of 2020, and they've been working through this four-year transition period, and it's tough for them to, you know, have to wait this long for football, but finally it's here.
The one thing that I notice is that when I look at the quality of play tonight, this is a Division I game.
Yeah.
We have Division I players all over the field tonight. I've been so impressed, not only with the quarterback play, but the offensive lines, I think, have been good. We've seen some great one-on-one tackling. The speed of the game is certainly Division I. You know, not to say that Division II is anything inferior, but this is not going to be your 1800s Tarleton State that we're going to be seeing from this point forward.
It's the first of 4 years of provisional membership for Tarleton as they transition to fully fledged D1. Ivy League is the only FCS conference to not play in the spring, and one other one joined them last week. But a 16-team bracket, 11 teams automatically qualify. Normally, it's a more expanded bracket than that, but they're condensing it down. Championship game is going to be played in Frisco, by the way, in the FCS at Toyota Stadium on May 16th.
I love that, right in everybody's backyard around here. And I love the fact that you take a look at the schedules that these teams have constructed, and given the fact that these
10-10 our score as we get ready to start the third quarter here at Stephenville, Texas. A cold night, that means a little bit more of a sparse crowd, but make no mistake, Stephenville is excited for football. And you know, Lon Riesman, the athletic director at Tarleton, told the Star-Telegram, hey, this week we're just pretending we're the Green Bay Packers. Just pretending this is Lambeau. This is just normal for us. But, you know, both sides have looked ready to play despite it being a really cold night. They don't care. They're on the field for the first time in more than a year.
Well, you know, check back in about 12 hours. It will look like Lambeau Field once that blizzard moves in. But, boy, this Tarleton State fandom, they're so excited about football at the Division I level, and they should be. I watch this, and, you know, as a former Texan myself, I watch this ball game tonight, and I just can't believe how far this program has come in such a short time.
From JUCO.
Yes.
To NAIA, four-year institution back in 61. Took a long time to get to the D2 level, and now D1 joining the WAC, and looky, they've got some bunkmates from Texas that are going to be joining them in the WAC as well.
Abilene Christian, longtime LSC member themselves, Lamar, Sam Houston State, Stephen F. Austin, a team that they beat, by the way.
Yeah, as a
Division I opponent, and then Southern Utah, too.
Absolutely, and that's going to help the WAC get football back, something they have not had since several years ago when they ended up dropping it. And the overall addition creates a 13-team conference. Not enough football teams for two divisions, but for other sports like the men's and women's basketball, the baseball, the softball, things like that, they'll be able to create two divisions so you can keep the play more centralized during the regular season, then go to one site for conference tournaments.
And you know what helps all of these teams like Tarleton and Lamar and Abilene Christian? They're not only moving to Division I, John, but they're moving into a conference that already has that branding.
Yeah, the WAC.
The WAC. Everybody knows the WAC. They're bringing football back. It's not something that you're having to start from the ground level to market.
And down the line, maybe a five-year plan, says Dr. James Hurley, the president at Tarleton, they may try to make the jump to FBS and look at it down the line as a conference that's going to be the highest level of college football and back to the level where the WAC was before they disbanded football.
Well, look, they've got an upgraded stadium. You've got brand new.
Are we going all the way till the, yeah, okay, I see 53. Okay, thanks.
Backs to play Texas Tech, Texas A&M. Those would be big-time games for this program. And you go from 36 scholarships at the Division II level to now 59 scholarships. And look at the attendance. The attendance at Tarleton State since 2015 has doubled.
Wow.
The winning has helped. But you make that move to Division I, it's a game changer.
More than 8,000 fans a game. They've added on here to Memorial Stadium. You've seen the establishing shots of this gigantic stadium. And it's not the way that it used to be. This used to be the roadside, basically. They built a new home side over that roadside. And it's two-tiered. It's beautiful. You got a few luxury suites here. And then you also have the former home side, which serves as the roadside these days. They can pack 12,000 in here when we're not talking about social distancing.
Yep. And I remember coming to the campus back when Dr. Ron Newsom and I were doing games. I remember coming to the campus, this must have been 15 years ago, and even back then, how much it had changed in such a short time. They put a lot of money into it, making facility upgrades, new student center, things like that. This is becoming a destination for students and athletes alike, where they really want to land.
After seeking some shelter from the cold during the halftime back in the concourse, about ready to start the second half. That's where I want to be, right there, the heater.
I was
right
wondering
there.
If those heaters were, hey, if they're in the tents, goodness, that is the place to be.
Exactly. Great place to watch a game from in that north end zone. And you see the Tarleton State fans really excited about making this jump to Division I. Started out as a 10-0 lead for McNeese. Tarleton State has since tied it up. And we're ready to go to the second half. Teams are on the field. McNeese gets the ball to start the second half and try to rip back some momentum from this Tarleton team that's feeling good after tying it up. Dangerous return man, Jacoby Skinner, waiting back. Skinner, man, runs right into consternation. He is pushed back hard by Zek Hopkins. Nothing doing.
Zek Hopkins has had a really good game for Tarleton already. And McNeese, you see that Hopkins, the redshirt junior, the kind of talent he has, the Blinn Junior College transfer.
So a chance for McNeese and Cody Ogeron to try to retake control of this game. We just haven't made enough in this one about how proud the Lake Charles area must be of this Cowboy football team for even being back on the field after those two hurricanes came through, devastated that area back in the fall.
Yeah, and hats off to Cody Ogeron. He could have easily said, you know what, I think I'd like to leave and go somewhere else. He's decided to stay and make this his home and keep it his home. He's very proud to play here.
Gives it to McMahon on first down, and coming off the bottom of the pile, Zek Hopkins, who also made the special teams tackle, a 3-yard pickup on that play. So Cody Ogeron in the first half, though, inaccurate at times. Tarleton's defense has made it tough.
They have. The secondary play has been above average tonight, and you would expect it to be, given the fact that it's so hard to function through the air, given these frigid conditions.
McNeese moving into the wind right now. They'll have the wind in the fourth quarter. On second down, Ogeron goes to the air and laying out, but dropping the football. Another drop by Josh Matthews. Second time he's had it in his hands and dropped it in this one, third down.
Yeah, it's been a tough catch for Matthews, the Louisiana Tech transfer. A lot of times he finds himself in double coverage, but tonight he's had some space to make some grabs. Big third down coming up now for Big Neese. They don't want to start this half going three and out after giving up the touchdown going into the break.
Oh, no doubt about it. Trying to rip back some momentum on third and six. Ogeron, a nice pocket. Good soft spot.
Wow.
Oh, and a lick. It was dropped again by Josh Matthews, but a huge hit by Ronnell Wilson, and it draws not one, but three flags.
If you are an official in the vicinity of the stadium, your flag was thrown on that one. Ronnell Wilson absolutely laid out Matthews with a helmet-to-helmet hit. I'm sure that's going to be a targeting penalty. They'll probably use a booth review to kind of look at it. But I thought initially that the flag would come out, and we saw four of them.
Vidal Jones is the referee. And you're exactly right. A fourth has shown up as well. Wilson in the right place, but not doing exactly the right thing.
Brown feels an incomplete pass. It was a personal foul targeting number one of his defense. It's a 15-yard penalty. Previous play is under review.
Yeah, they'll look at it. That's Ronnell Wilson. You want to be physical in the secondary, but at the same time, you want to be smart, too. And Josh Matthews having that ball dislodged, they pulled him from the game, and they need to just to check him out, make sure he's okay. That, by the way, is the most vicious hit we've seen tonight.
Ronnell Wilson was really excited to play in this game. He's a guy that's been here for 5 years, came on his visit, under Coach Witten as we get a look at it here. He does lead with the helmet, but also tries to reach out with the arms. What do you think, Scott?
Looking at it here, just to get a second glance at it, I thought initially that there was no question. I think there's no doubt that they made the right call on that.
That's an even worse look there for Tarleton. But, you know, the point is that Wilson's been a team leader. This would be a big loss for them if he was ejected.
Well, you look at Wilson and Hafford at that cornerback spot, Trey Johnson, Eric Willis. These are guys, these are the cornerstones of this Tarleton defense that came here when the defense wasn't any good. Coach Witten was trying to build it, and those players that I just mentioned had the faith to sign here, to play here, and boy, have they certainly proven themselves and proven that they can be guys you can count on.
Wilson told a local TV station that he was ready to explode coming into this game. It was a surreal feeling. And talking about it now, but his knee's kind of weak. Well, he's hoping that his night doesn't end early because of a targeting penalty.
You know, he's bulky. He's a pivotal senior player on this team. And this is a pivotal season for him, the Abilene, Texas native, who had 82 tackles last year, seven of those for a loss. They you lose your Mike linebacker, it changes things completely. Khalid Johnson from Terrell would probably come up to play for him if he should be ejected here.
At further review, ruling of targeting is confirmed. Number one of the defense has been disqualified.
Wilson still in there and trying to be a vocal leader for his team. He doesn't have to leave the sideline, but he must leave the field. And on one hand, we've seen it a couple times. We know it was an illegal hit. There is no doubt about that. On the other hand, you feel for the senior playing in his first Division I game, a moment he's been waiting for 5 years.
You know, before they had targeting, I mean, that was not only a legal hit, but a lauded hit. You know, defensive coordinators all around the country would want a player that would levy a lick like that, but you've got to be careful these days.
Khalid Johnson does come in to play that spot, and that one is fumbled
that
forward,
should be a
but
shovel
that's an
pass.
Incomplete pass. Yeah,
it should be an incomplete pass.
Unless it was picked out of the air, which it was not. Jordan Wells got right in there and dislodged the football on the shovel pass. What a play by the end.
Yeah, good call right there by the official. No doubt that ball was passed forward. I thought for a minute that ball might get intercepted. There was so much congestion in there.
The whole Tarleton team came off the field thinking it was third down or something. They're back out there now. Let's get a look.
I think they thought that it was a turnover.
Good point. But no, it's still a great play by Jordan Wells, but just an incomplete pass. A handoff to McMahon, And after McMahon early on had some things going in the running game, I tell you, the Charlton defense has made some key adjustments, even without Ronnell Wilson out there, to start stopping the running game of McNeese.
One of the big adjustments that I see is that they're turning it up defensively. They are swarming that football right now. I don't know what Todd Whitten told them in the locker room, but they have come out and they are ready to go.
Here's a third down and 10. Cody Orgeron and McNeese trying to figure out a way to make a third down. Orgeron has some time, now running out of it. Flag down. Orgeron completes one, and it's right at the sticks, caught by Josh Matthews. Good to see him back in the game. That's enough for the first down, but we're checking the flag after the gain of 10.
Probably going to be holding in the interior of the line. There were two blitzing linebackers that they were trying to keep off of Orgeron. I don't think they did it cleanly.
71, offense. 10 yards from the previous spot. It's third down.
Cameron Coleman got called for it, that Coffeyville transfer. Junior transfer, 6'2", 300-pounder, big, strong, a guy that can move. But that time, they got him for holding. Watch 71 right here, and he just gets beat to the inside. You'd never want to get beat to the inside. A pretty easy call. Jordan Wells has been getting repeated penetration, and Coleman was left relegated to hold.
Wells, a home record. Here's third and 20. Orgeron trying to find somebody. Running out of time and out of options. Bryson Collins runs him out of bounds, and a big stand to start the third quarter for the Texan defense.
And I just thought it was a great play by Bryson Collins, a backup linebacker in there for Harris right now out of San Diego. Didn't get over anxious, did not try to get Orgeron and make a sensational play. He was patient. He made the solid play, forced him to the sideline, and forces McNeese into a punt.
Just got to contain Cody Orgeron.
Yep.
Back deep, Kalen Horton. He's had a big kick return in this one, but did muff a punt earlier. There's Bailey Rayborn. Rayborn's punt straight up into the air. It's a short one, fair catch called for, and Horton ranges over to make the grab, even though it was into the wind. So McNeese and Charlton tied up at 10. The defense gets a stand for Charlton. The Texans have scored 10 straight. Now we'll see what the offense has.
This Charlton defense really setting the tone when the second quarter began. You look back at what Charlton was able to accomplish after giving up the touchdown. They end up forcing the turnover on downs. Second quarter, punt, and then the half ended. So they didn't do hardly anything. This McNeese team really had a hard time moving the football in that second quarter and putting points up.
Back on as the running back is Raheem Skinner, had 6 carries for 28, the only touchdown in the first half. And this is a flea flicker. It bounces back to Stephen Duncan. Duncan steps up anyway, looking deep for Benson, and it's broken up. What a one-on-one play by Colby Richardson.
What great arm shown by Duncan. And tell you what, we've seen some great plays in that defensive secondary. Colby Richardson has broken up at least 2 that have been really important tonight. How many times do you see a flea flicker with a ball bouncing and still no pressure on the quarterback to disrupt the rhythm?
It's a great point. That is the second breakup of Stephen Duncan's passes, 9 of 20 so far. This time Skinner with the call, but trips over his own lineman. And it's a third down and long. He couldn't get around the center, Austin Whitehead.
Now Mason Kinsey pushing the defensive tackle and disrupting that nice bull rush right there by Kinsey. Didn't allow himself to get reached and disrupted the timing of that run. It looked like it was going to be a power to the middle, and it forces Tarleton to convert on now third down and 11.
Stephen Duncan, 6'6", redshirt junior transfer out of Western Kentucky. His first year as a starter at Tarleton. Goes up top. He's got a man, it's underthrown, but taking it away is Tyreek Benson. Tyreek Benson with a huge take off the helmet of Colby Richardson.
Leighton Ernst ended up getting beat, I believe, by Chambers, the defensive end. Chambers putting all kinds of pressure on Duncan. Duncan still able to step into that throw and make it, but what a grab by Benson to pluck it off the top of the head of the defender for a big play.
They go right back to the air. Dre Roberson with the short catch this time, but it stays ahead of the chains as Mason Kinsey makes the stop on the play.
And Tarleton really doing what McNeese was able to do on their first couple of drives when this ball game began. We're seeing Tarleton now controlling the tempo, controlling how things are going. Steve Duncan really managing the game quite well.
Wow, 34-yard catch by Bitson there. Now they're inside the 25. Out of the tackle, Skinner. Skinner to the inside. And a first down to the 13.
You look at all of the position groups that Tarleton is putting on the field. Offensive linemen, backs, tight ends, wide receivers. The running back combination of Banks and Skinner. Look at Skinner breaking a tackle. Nice cut, gets vertical, and now he's close to the 10-yard line.
Another shot to the end zone. Bitson high points it. He's got it. Touchdown. Tariq Bitson with two huge catches on this drive, and Tarleton has their first lead.
Joyce, the Tulane transfer, trying to cover Bitson. Bitson in a groove right now with Steve Duncan. Back-to-back throws to perhaps your best wide receiver, and Tariq Bitson, who's a one-for-one guy, the Adams State transfer, making two tremendous catches on this drive to give Tarleton their first lead as a Division I player.
Welcome into Stephenville. Bitson making his name known. And the extra point fired through. Tarleton has scored 17 straight to go up by 7 on McNeese.
Well, look at this play right here. Tremendous timing route. Duncan going to Bitson with a guy draped all over him. Great catch with his back to the end zone.
New dynamic duo in Stephenville. 11 plus 1, Duncan plus Bitson equals 6. Tarleton Texans up 17 to 10, a 6-play drive, 60 yards, and really a coming out for Bitson on that drive.
That's a nice algebraic equation. It may remind some former Tarleton players of some defensive schemes that might have gotten a little bit too technical, too complicated. They've simplified things, and boy, they are hitting on all cylinders right now.
And McNeese desperately looking for a spark to get back in. Skinner races to the outside, or rather, that's Pierce, but he is cut down hard. Beautiful play made by Donovan Banks on the special teams, and the Tarleton Texans have turned it up in every facet.
They have, and teams that are dominant in special teams and on defense are really good teams, and I love to watch this Tarleton State team. And you look at Tarleton by the numbers, and last year this Tarleton team only gave up 269 yards a game, only 98 on the ground.
Wow.
Per contest.
Wow.
That is a dominant defense. That's how you win every regular season game. They've continued to build on that.
Cody Ogeron threw a touchdown pass to Josh Matthews, the only touchdown for McNeese. They're just trying to get something going. Ogeron trying to go underneath to Pettigrew, but it's read like a book. The Texans are there at every turn.
Every turn, indeed. And I'm watching Eric Willis, that backup defensive end, who had a great year last year, the walk-on. Really skinny in high school. He's gotten into the weight room. He was on a beeline right at Ogeron to make him get rid of that football in a hurry. And right now, Tarleton, since they scored that touchdown, it has invigorated this unit, and they are putting big-time pressure on the McNeese offense.
That offensive line is under assault right now.
Wow.
And keeping it, Ogeron, he goes down hard. Bryson Collins, the backup linebacker, playing his debut at Tarleton with the tackle for loss.
We've seen Collins with Wilson out, Harris, Trey Johnson. They're doing a really good job at that linebacker spot, and now it's third down and long. And the problem that you have now, look at that penetration, just tremendous ability by Collins. And we talked about just being able to tackle in space. Great job getting him down.
Third down, 14. Little screen pass going nowhere to Josh Matthews. Another huge hit. Collins does it again.
Wow.
That is Zach Hopkins.
Zach Hopkins, the blend transfer, the Cuero native, that tall, rangy defensive end. It's almost like some of these guys can't get blocked now. Some guys have a hard time pressing and shedding and getting off blocks. I'm wondering if Hopkins is even getting blocked.
Tarleton Texans, to a man, have started playing with more effort.
Look at that. They tried to run the screen, and you talk about blowing it up and getting to the point of attack. It's a defense that's well-coached, and they are aggressive.
Defensive coordinator Marcus Patton has turned this thing around. There's a flag down, and the play clock expired unless there was a timeout called.
Play game. Offense number 38. It's a 5-yard penalty. Fourth down.
Well, the blue and gold didn't call a timeout there. So for McNeese, it just adds insult to injury and makes this punt into the wind even tougher here.
So did they get a delay call and they got charged with a timeout?
Charged timeout.
Oh, welcome there, to Stephenville.
There it is. There is the timeout.
Nice. Well, hey, I'll tell you what. You look at McNeese, and I know that this is a better McNeese team than what we saw last year. But this McNeese team, they gave up 37 sacks last year. And you look at Frank Wilson, the first-year head coach, it's something that they've got to shore up. And I'm a little bit surprised, given as big and strong and athletic as this McNeese offensive line is. They averaged over 300 pounds on that offensive front. They've been giving up some big plays in this third quarter to a Tarleton defensive front.
And it looks like Wilson is a little stunned at how all of a sudden Tarleton's being so aggressive.
They're being aggressive, and they own the tempo right now. This is this is really about as good as it gets. We did not see this in the first half from Tarleton.
Rayborn gets it away, but straight up into that wind, and this is going to hit short. Not even at the 35-yard line. Takes a lateral bounce. I mean, it's going nowhere. That's only a punt of 22 yards. And Tarleton takes over in great position.
Not only are you having to punt into a stiff, cold wind, but then you factor in a miss hit on top of that, and Tarleton State is less than 35 yards away from making this a two-score game, and they were down by two scores early.
They were, and they were turning the ball over. It just didn't look like a very good D1 debut for Tarleton. They looked a little nervous. They looked a little on edge, but there is a groove now for the purple and white.
It looked like they were playing in 20-degree weather or something down there to start.
Well, it is 20 degrees. Believe it or not, here in the hill country of Texas, and there's also a blizzard warning or a...
I saw some ice on branches coming into town.
Steven Duncan back in at quarterback, and somehow that ball pops to Skinner, and Skinner's going to make a lot out of this. Raheem Skinner pushing the pile before his forward progress is stopped for 7.
You know, the only negative thing that has happened to Tarleton is getting Wilson ejected with that targeting foul on the first defensive series for Tarleton State. You look at this play, and boy, the brakes are just going their way right now. That was not by design, I promise you, but they're still able to make 7 out of it.
Maybe they'll call it again. Second down 3, and another give to Skinner. Doesn't normally go down on the first hit or the second, but still, there is enough penetration for a 2-yard loss as McNeese decides they have had enough of Raheem Skinner.
Interesting call right here, because midway through the third, you've got a chance to take a 2-score lead. It's 3rd down at 6, ordinarily a passing down. If they want to make this 4-down territory, they could hand the ball off. They've had success on the ground.
Duncan pulls it back, throws it underneath. Roberson can't get free. Picks up 1, maybe 2. Now they'll give him 3. Colby Richardson on the tackle. Now it is 4th and 3.
Yeah,
what does Tarleton do?
Little throw to the hook zone here. Given that they've got the point, we've already seen a long field goal that was made earlier by the Temple native in frigid conditions, but they're going to go for it.
Here's the 4th and 3 going right to the air, flagged down. Roberson has the first down and more, it was stopped.
I don't think everybody was set.
No, I don't think so either.
Prior to snap, false start on the offense. Not all players were set. Number 22 was moving prior to the snap. That's 5-yard penalty, remains 4th down.
Now you got a deeper field goal opportunity, but a 4th and 8.
Yeah, this would be a long field goal in warm conditions, but it looks like they're going to try it.
Adrian Guzman, freshman kicker, comes on as Stephen Duncan comes to the sideline. Talking to Coach Witten about that 4th down play, but this is going to be a 50-yard field goal. See if Tarleton has too many on the field and they have not enough. Now it's just right. Plenty of time to snap it. Adrian Guzman from 50 with the wind behind him. He's got the leg. It's no good. Adrian Guzman, plenty of distance on it, but just inaccurate, and Tarleton can't take advantage of the excellent field position.
Had the leg, didn't completely stay behind it, kind of wrapped his leg a little bit, got around it, hooked it, and boy, McNeese averts disaster because Tarleton was set up with a short field on the 34 of McNeese on first and 10, and the Texans don't come up with points. That's a big miss.
It's a big miss. It's a big win as well for McNeese, getting strong there to turn things around. Head coach Todd Whitten in his fifth year of his third stint. Yeah, three different stints at Tarleton as the head coach. 1996, he was the head coach for 1 year. And then a second stint that was a lot longer from 2000 to 2004, a couple playoff appearances in D2. Now back after back-to-back playoff appearances here, moving the team to D1. A.J. Carter with the first down carry for McNeese. 3-yard pickup, and Trey Johnson spills him.
Johnson doing a good job of getting to the edge. They try to bounce it that time. Can't quite turn the corner. That's just sort of how it's gone here in the early goings of the third quarter for McNeese.
A.J. Carter, the transfer out of Arizona State, has gotten a lot of the running back snaps as this game's gone on. He's trying to calm things down after Tarleton took control. Another give to Carter. Carter bursting past the 40. And bounces down 1 yard shy of the first down. Another tackle for Zach Hopkins.
It's a nice play. McNeese going back to the ground where they're having good success tonight. You look at the rushing yards, and McNeese with 116 yards on the ground coming into the drive compared to Tarleton's 91.
He's Scott Garner. I'm John Little. D1 debut for Tarleton State. McNeese back on the field after 488 days without playing. On third down, Carter tries to pick a hole. He may be short. He's brought down by Chadwick Thibodeau right now. And that spot is a big negatory for McNeese.
If he doesn't get it, this would be a really interesting call for first-year head coach Frank Wilson. That was just a simple inside zone run, nothing fancy. And Tarleton got enough penetration and got the linebacker Phil to be short of the first down. And it's like Coach Wilson wants to go for it. Is he going to call a timeout to talk about it? Now they're going to review.
So McNeese waiting until there was a review, and we'll see about the spot of this ball if there are any of the camera angles that can tell us whether or not it was short of the first down. We'll take a break. Tarleton leads 17-10, pending a review. It's either fourth down, a little better spot for McNeese. That's it.
At further review, the ruling on the field of the runner being short of the line of gain is confirmed. It's fourth down.
So it was a good call. It ends up that A.J. Carter was short. And on fourth down and one, the punting unit comes on for McNeese.
That was a good call, that first look, get a second look at it here. And ended up getting stood up by Chad Thibodeau, that strong side linebacker who kind of doubles as a defensive end.
Thibodeau really getting his nose in there. A little pressure this time, much better punt from Bailey Rayborn. Fair catch called for it, and going down to a knee, Horton pulls it in at the 23-yard line. So Tarleton up 17-10, trailed 10-0 early, but since then has clawed back with 17 straight. Stephen Duncan, number 11 there, the quarterback, with a touchdown pass to Tariq Bitson, the go-ahead score.
It's interesting, the troubles that the Texans had on the ground sort of were erased on that touchdown drive right before the half, but still you look at the numbers of McNeese with 122 yards on the ground compared to Tarleton's 91, but Tarleton has almost double the number of yards because Tarleton has 160 in the air. McNeese has less than 50.
We haven't seen Khalil Banks in the backfield in a while. Another drive for true freshman Braylon Bridges out of Houston. Offset to the left of Duncan. Duncan to the air. Roberson, he's been open all night. He's taken down after a quick 2-yard pickup to the 25. A
nice little hitch there to Roberson, who's got great hands. And again, if he's able to turn up field, he's a good one to get yards after the catch, those yak yards. But they rallied to the football very quickly out of that zone coverage.
Roberson's freshman year last season, 5 catches for 50 and a score. He might have that in this game tonight. Duncan back to the air on second down. He looks so comfortable back there, but just overshoots Roberson, trying to go up the seam to the slot receiver. Third down.
And from his vantage point, thank goodness he did, because he had Corey McCoy coming over from that safety position, who had 3 picks, second most on the team last year. And he had an idea of trying to pluck that one out of the air.
Stoppage as there's a man down for McNeese right in the middle of the field. Looks like a calf cramp for Andre Sam. How do you get a cramp on a 20-degree night?
I get that man a banana. Get him some potassium. Andre Sam, the junior 2-year letterman, again, the best defensive back that they had, a converted safety, really as good as they get, really smart, made some great plays tonight. He's physical, and a guy that, you know, could have easily gone into the transfer portal. The guy that they lost a couple to the transfer portal, in fact, Darian Dunn, who went to Texas, and Colby Burton, who ended up going to Louisiana Monroe, but Sam ends up staying here, and he's been a great mainstay for this secondary for McNeese.
Yeah, the McNeese corners have played fairly well tonight. Really holding their own against the outstanding outside receivers for Tarleton. Third down and 8 for Duncan and the Tarleton offense. Duncan goes back to the air, comes back right on the hitch. Catch is made by Gabe Douglas. Now a matter of the spot. It's right on it. They're going to give him the first down at the 33. He sat down right at the stick, Scott.
Yeah, and I thought Leighton Ernest, the left tackle, did a really good job on Ernest Grayson, who got off. You watch Grayson there on the left side. Ernest does a good job of taking him where he wants to go, because Grayson got an early start out of the shoot, was almost offside, and they're able to move the sticks on that play.
First down from the 33. Now a back shoulder throw, incomplete for Gabe Douglas as he goes after the junior out of Denton Ryan, about an hour and a half away. Actually grew up in Shreveport, but did his high school work at Denton Ryan, then on to Kilgore College. Second down.
And we've seen Chris Joyce over there at that nickel spot, and Ridge Tejada. Tejada, a freshman who started for McNeese at that nickel position, who's had a couple of brothers that have played big-time college football. Ranthony Tejada with TCU and Riley Tejada with Baylor. Tejada had his interception wiped out via penalty.
Here comes the heat, but a throw underneath for Roberson. Roberson making man miss. The spin out past the 40. And he's close for a first down. Give him 9 before Darius Daniels finally lassos the tough-to-catch Dre Roberson.
Right, Roberson out of the YML Academy in Fort Worth. Terrific hands, but I love what he can do after the catch. Shook not one, but 2 guys that almost got him there. There's the first one, and able to spin off a second one to get very close to first down yardage. That changes everything on third down.
And a sneak opportunity for 6'6" Duncan. And Duncan surges forward right there at the sticks again. It's going to depend on the spot, but it looks like another first down for Tarleton, already leading by 7 here in the third quarter.
That's 4, almost 5 feet that they needed on that sneak. But the center Whitehead doing a really good job. That Northeast Oklahoma JUCO transfer with a nice push down there.
Well, Duncan's 6, almost 7 feet, so it works out. Duncan back to the air. Roberson, they're wearing out his hands. This time a catch for just a gain of 1. But Stephen Duncan, 6'6" junior, originally from Charleston, South Carolina, holds all the Ashley Ridge High School passing records. First ever FBS recruit for Ashley Ridge as he went to Western Kentucky, and was in line to start probably in the fall of 2020, but elected to graduate as there's a timeout on the field. Another man is down, but elected to graduate early. You see Colby Richardson there. Hopefully he's going to be okay. But Duncan
graduating early from Western Kentucky, transferring here to Tarleton. He's going after not one master's degree, but he's going after two while he's here because he's got 2 years of eligibility left.
I love it, and you know, he's really the future of this team. Western Kentucky, you know, they went 9-4. He started the first three ball games in 2019, got the medical red shirt, had an injured foot. He had a foot problem back then, and we see the numbers on Duncan tonight, 17 of 30, as you mentioned, 170 yards. He's got a 115 rating here. But he's done a good job, and I think as this game has gone along, he's managed it better. The timing's been much better. We've seen him hook up with Tariq Bitson on a couple of big plays, especially on that touchdown drive that throws to J.F. Thomas on the timing stuff. A lot of RPO stuff, but he's big and he's strong, and he's really solid. You can see why Coach Witten was so impressed with him coming into the season.
Yeah, no doubt about it. As you get a look there at Kobe Richardson after Andre Sam just went out. Richardson, the junior out of New Orleans, McMaine High School. Kind of the walking wounded on the back end for McNeese, and they are able to get Andre Sam back in, but these are key spots.
Remember, Richardson was hurt early last year, and he went down earlier in the game and came back.
Tarleton's been trying to pick on the edges all game. Those home run balls finally started to stick a few of them in the second half. Second down and long, and back to the ground. Here's Braylon Bridges. Bridges for a quick five out to the 49-yard line before being pushed back. Third down, four upcoming for Tarleton as Enos Lewis, the boundary safety, makes the stop.
Bridges, Banks, Skinner. They've got a slew of running backs, and I love how they're using them tonight. Bridges has, what, six carries now? Skinner with 10, Banks with three. They're really spreading the wealth, and the one thing that they like to do is to keep their backs fresh as they get into the fourth quarter of games.
Third and four, Duncan back to the air, going up top down the sideline, and a flag comes in. Incomplete for Tariq Bitson. But that one-on-one matchup with Chris Joyce, Joyce never looked back.
I'm not sure if the contact warranted a flag, but I know that when he didn't turn his head around, that there was about a 90% chance that the flag was going to come out. Notice how the official in front of the play didn't throw it, but the one behind it did.
Pass interference, number five of the defense. 15 yards from the previous spot, it's first down.
Take another look here.
You watch this. Again, I didn't think that the contact was all that egregious, but when you don't turn around, you're just inviting a flag to be thrown.
Another first down for Tarleton State. Texans move the sticks on the seventh penalty for 70 yards on McNeese. All the way down to the 37 of McNeese. Duncan. Wearing out Roberson again. Roberson getting vertical. Down to the 27. He's near another first down, a yard short.
Yeah, just making cornerbacks and outside linebackers make plays out there. Safety dropping down to the box on that play. And great read, great pre-snap read by Duncan. And a great play call to make their players make plays.
Roberson with 9 catches already. And a late handoff here, but bursting through the hole is Bridges. Bridges with the cutback, the quick feet, the score! Oh, making something out of nothing. Braylon Bridges, the freshman, scampers for 27.
We saw 3 tremendous moves right there by Bridges, who looked anything but like a freshman on that last run. What a great cut, got past the first wave, and then made a great read, and then got vertical just like that. Boy, he's going to be a really nice addition, and is a nice addition. The Klein Collins High School product out of Houston, Texas, the freshman, getting some much-deserved high fives there and some love from his teammates.
Extra point goes. It doesn't look like he's 160 pounds dripping wet. He's a smallish guy. He ran for over 2,000 yards as a senior last year. Here he uses the patience, the vision, the burst, and Tarleton goes up by 14. Tonight marks the historic season.
Meeting of the minds after Tarleton State drives for yet another score. Maybe their most impressive drive of the game, converting a couple third downs by Stephen Duncan, and then after that, a 27-yard touchdown run by Bridges. It all adds up to 24 unanswered for the Texans in their D1 debut. It is a takeover, Scott Carr.
Yeah, had a 73-yard touchdown drive right before the half to tie the ball game at 10, and this one right here gives them a 24-10 advantage. A 77-yard drive, 10 plays, and it takes 3:31 off the clock.
And McNeese needs a burst in the worst way. And in this case, they're not going to get it. Mason Pierce snowed under. Tarleton's just played more and more solid and found their footing as this game has gone on, and they have looked like the better team as the game's gone on.
Well, Tarleton, I love their mindset coming out of the locker room. I think that was the biggest difference. A lot of coaches will tell you that the most important segment of any football game, the 4 minutes going into halftime and the 4 minutes coming out of halftime.
Yeah.
And I thought the offense for Tarleton going into halftime, the final 4 minutes, really set the tone for the rest of the game. They got the game tied. And then coming out of the break, the Tarleton State defense, they were flying around, letting hit after hit. And they forced the back-to-back punt. In fact, we've seen three straight punts by the McNeese offense, and it all started with a big hitting, one of which led to an ejection on a targeting foul. But nonetheless, it was a mindset, and it's the defensive intensity that has continued that momentum swing.
And then eventually the touchdown by Braylon Bridges, the true freshman. We also saw Enos Lewis, the starting boundary safety for McNeese, come out of the game. Hopefully he's going to be okay. But it's time for McNeese to right the ship. It has been a rough 6 months for McNeese, a rough 6 months for Lake Charles. Hurricane Laura coming through. Hurricane Zeta as well, a rainmaker, destroying their football field. McNeese started out with a 10-0 lead, trying to regain some momentum. And a first down run here for Jacoby Skinner. First time we've seen Skinner in the backfield in a while. Pick up a four.
Yeah, Jacoby Skinner, not big, fast, and a guy that is a good kick returner, too. He can break the tackle. He can find some holes. Skinner had 244 yards last year. Not a big play guy, and I like that McNeese is not abandoning the ground game, even though they're down by two scores here.
Well, plenty of time to go here. 2 minutes left in this cold third quarter. Another chance for Skinner, but this time Tarleton is the wiser. And getting off the back of the at the bottom of the pile, Blake Heel, along with several of the other defensive linemen.
And we have now seen five straight punts by McNeese going back to the start of the second quarter. And if they don't do something here, it'll be a three and out, and Tarleton could take this thing into the fourth quarter with a two-score lead.
Skinner has been limited, so has Orgeron to his right. Before a third down and six, Tarleton State calls a timeout. Yeah, McNeese was having some success on third down early on in this game, but now they're just 5 of 13. And again, that's a down that I want to say last season, or last year, but it was last season, 2019. 33% just not going to get it done, you know, as far as that third down conversion rate. And that's something that the new coaching staff really wanted to improve coming into this year.
Yeah, and McNeese tonight just 5 of 13, as we talked about last year. Again, they had a hard time. They were just 67 of 202. Tarleton, a little bit better than that at 43%. Both teams would love to improve in that category, but certainly McNeese. This, I think, is the biggest third down of the game. You do not want to go three and out at this juncture.
Not after just going down by two touchdowns. Third down, a long five here for McNeese. They need the 33 for a first. Orgeron with four receivers. And he uses his legs. Orgeron slides for a first down out to the 39.
One of the best plays by the offensive line for McNeese in a while. Tarleton brought pressure. Both linebackers came through A-gaps, but it was picked up, and Orgeron found a little hole and was able to scamper for the first.
Orgeron keeps on the zone read here, but he's ripped down. Big play by Trey Johnson, the nickel back.
Yeah, but I thought Hafford really made the play. He sets the hard edge, and then they get the great play from the inside by Trey Johnson, that nickelback coming over to make that tackle, limit it to a two-yard run. If that edge isn't set, Orgeron might be able to turn the corner.
You're always looking out for the lineman, aren't you? Tarleton Texans call timeout as there is, or rather, there's an injury timeout. Eric Willis was down, but he's able to come off under his own power. Remember, this is the first game for both teams after 488 days. They both played on the same day. November 23rd, 2019 was the last time they were on the field, so it's been a long time since they've been in real game action. We've seen a few nicks, a few cuts so far. Hopefully no big injuries, though.
Yeah, Eric Willis, you see that defensive end right there, the senior out of Lawndale, California. A little gimpy there. He's doing a good job with Zach Hopkins rotating into that defensive end position tonight.
Second down, 8 for McNeese.
But Tarleton not afraid to play press coverage and bring pressure.
Just one safety back. Orgeron throws the stop route, left side. Good connection to Josh Matthews. Knew just when to throw it to the back shoulder.
Because Franklin really, I thought, had good coverage. I thought that was a great route run, a great pass. Maybe the best by Orgeron this half. And then Matthews making a really good catch.
Quick gain of 10, and they go quickly. Skinner into the line. Not much there for him. Just a pickup of 1 before he's ripped down. Oh, there's a man down, yeah.
That looks like it's Coleman, the guard.
Yeah, the left guard, Caron Coleman, is not getting up quite yet. Coleman is a big protector of Cody Orgeron.
Tell you what, that tells you a lot about Tarleton and what they think they can do against a team like McNeese. Again, they're not the McNeese that we saw 5-10 years ago. It's been, what, 5 years since they won 10 games in a season. Last year they won 7, year before that 6, and they've had kind of a revolving door at that head coaching position, and Frank Wilson trying to change that. But you watch Tarleton, their DBs matching up and playing press coverage, going man and pressuring Orgeron. That tells you, hey, Tarleton thinks not only is it better, but they think they can dominate, and they're doing it right now.
Yeah, the ones be ones here, yeah. Our ones are better than your ones. That's what they're saying. And here's the thing for McNeese. I know you mentioned they're not the dominant program of old, and absolutely will take that. But 15 straight winning seasons, that's nothing to shake your head at. That's the most in FCS currently. 15 straight. It's not since 2004 when they went 4-7 that McNeese has failed to be on the top side at the end of the season.
And, you know, they're 7-3 the last 10 years in openers. And so a couple of those losses were against Nebraska and Kansas. So they're not playing, you know, the soft programs to start.
Exactly. When you factor out the FBS programs, season openers without FBS, they've won 9 of their last 10. But here they trail by 14 on the road, 2nd and long. Quarterback draw for Orgeron. He's able to wrap himself forward for a couple. Zach Hopkins making yet another play from that defensive end spot. 3rd down, long coming up for McNeese.
And when you watch Tarleton football and you compare what we've seen tonight with what Tarleton was putting on the field 5, 6, 7 years ago, I watch a play like that with a player like Orgeron on the draw and how players are just swarming it on the defensive side. Really nice job by the Texans.
Oh, no doubt about it. And the Tarleton Texans dominate the third quarter, taking it from a 10-all halftime nodding to a 14-point lead at the end of 3. They've done it through the air. They've done it on the ground. It looks like the Texans' night so far in Stephenville. Stay with us on Fox Sports Southwest. Texas under a winter storm warning. Well, here in Stephenville, Erath County, they're issuing a purple storm warning. Fourth quarter score, Tarleton up 24-10 on McNeese. And McNeese faces a big third down as we head to the fourth quarter. Welcome back in, John Little with Scott Garner and our entire Fox Sports Southwest crew. It's great to have you with us. Cody Orgeron, the son of Ed Orgeron, in at quarterback on third down. Pocket forms, finds his tight end over the middle. The LSU transfer, Jamal Pettigrew, with a big catch for a first down. Gain of 11.
Nice dig right there by Jamar Pettigrew. And Cody Orgeron, when he has had time, he has been able to go through his read progressions and make the throws. And I thought the offensive line did a really good job out of the timeout of pass protecting.
Back to the air. Orgeron off balance, but throws it up anyway. Just a little strong for Matthews as the heat came quick.
Matthews, by the way, never open on that. That time they did get pressure, but you look back, look at the nice pocket, and a good blitz pickup by Jacoby Skinner. The running backs for McNeese have had problems at times picking up the blitz. That time Jacoby Skinner, the two-year letterman, the junior running back, doing a good job of making certain that pocket stayed clean.
35-yard line of Tarleton. Big drive for McNeese to try to chop the lead in half. Skinner at the back. He gets the handoff. Straight ahead. Spinning. Picks up 6 yards. Darian Williams on the stop.
And the key for any player in any sport is balance. But Jacoby Skinner doing a really good job of keeping his balance off of the cut and picking up a little bit extra. You see him kind of taking a hard hit there. It hurts a little more on a night like tonight with the frigid temperatures, but that's a really nice run.
Jacoby Skinner really the third back in the program last year, playing more of a starter's role this season. Third down, 4. Orgeron pulls it down. Throws it up the sideline. Did Skinner get a foot in? Yes. First down to the 24-yard line. A 5-yard pickup.
And what a great find right there by Orgeron to keep his eyes downfield amid pressure, keeping the play alive, and just dumping it out to his running back to move the chains.
McNeese going tempo. Another one for Skinner. Cutting back and forth. Gaining positive yardage to try to keep the pressure on the Tarleton defense. But it's in this area of the field where the Tarleton Texans have stiffened a couple times.
While you watch this, and Orgeron able to keep the play alive. And as the defender came off of his man to put pressure on the quarterback, he's able to find the running back. Wow. And got just enough, got the foot in, that right foot to move the sticks.
Second down, 8 from the 23. You know the way Orgeron steps away from pressure and has the balance off both feet? Looks like a tennis player, I'm just saying. Tennis state champion back in Louisiana. Second and 8, Orgeron has to scramble out. Tries to keep it alive, throws it away. Good coverage on that side of the field by Devin Hafford, the former All-American. Second team All-American back in 2018 at that cornerback spot.
And a great decision by Orgeron to just throw that football away, showing a nice strong arm, threw it into the vicinity of the wide receiver out of bounds and put a lot on it, moving to his left. Really good athlete, Orgeron, as we mentioned tonight. 8 of 19 now, just 73 yards through the air. He just has not been able to get those explosive plays in the passing game that they were accustomed to seeing. They had problems in their first scrimmage this spring. The passing game had gotten better with each successive game, but it's not really where they wanted.
Here's 3rd and 8 from the 23. Orgeron finds a man up the middle. Soft catch, right hand to left. Right in the middle of the field by Markell Cotton to set up 1st and goal.
What a catch by Markell Cotton. Orgeron throws against his body. Cotton got hit helmet to helmet. Maybe another targeting foul coming up. But what a throw by Orgeron and a better catch by Cotton. Magnificent.
That is the first catch of his career. He redshirted last year.
A freshman out of Franklinton, Louisiana.
Byron Broussard and Donovan Banks were both there on the hit. That's where the flag comes down. It may mean even better field position for McNeese.
This drive kind of reminds you of that 15-play drive that Tarleton had right before the half. This may be even bigger than that one. It would make it a one-score game if they should score.
Referee tonight, Vidal Jones, part of the Southland crew. So they're going to review this play to see if Donovan Banks should be ejected. Remember earlier, first drive of the third quarter, Ronnell Wilson, the outstanding Tarleton linebacker, was ejected for a targeting call. And now you got Donovan Banks going under review. Thankfully, it looks like Markell Cotton is none worse for wear.
So if this is upheld, Tarleton will have lost its starting Mike and it's starting free safety. And this is very close to being a one-score game. And you look at this last play, I just thought it was magnificent. Rolling to your right, throw it back across your body, and almost a one-hand catch right there by Markell Cotton, the redshirt freshman. But he kind of tipped it to himself, and he knew the hit was coming, but he was able to secure it and make the catch.
And I just love the way he caught the tip of the football. Kind of cradled, cupped that hand around the very tip, the edge of the football, showing some great ball skills at a huge moment. That was third down 8.
And I thought for a moment, the way that ball was, I thought maybe that was Pettigrew. Pettigrew's got those tremendous hands and the tremendous ball skill. Cotton almost looked like a tight end over the middle there.
He's 6'2" instead of Pettigrew's 6'7". Doesn't quite have that exact wingspan, but certainly looked good there. Now the play goes under review. They're looking at this Donovan Banks hit to see whether or not it was a helmet-to-helmet targeting foul. And trying to see whether or not there's an ejection in order here. Either way, it's first and goal. It's either first and goal at the 4 or first and goal at the 2.
After review, there is no foul for targeting. It is first down, McNeese.
So a legal hit by Donovan Banks and Byron Broussard. And now the McNeese Cowboys are first and goal at the 4.
It's a big break right there because you lose Banks. That would be a big loss to a back end that's already lost one due to ejection.
McNeese 2 for 3 in the red zone. 1 touchdown, 1 field goal, 1 turnover on downs. And on first down, Skinner going absolutely nowhere. Zach Hopkins there along with Bryson Collins filling the hole. It's a loss of 1.
You know, Tarleton's been doing that. They've been walking those linebackers up or on the line of scrimmage as they go too tight end with a wing over there. I wouldn't be shocked to see maybe a play action fake here on this second down and goal play.
A.J. Carter was the running back, rather.
With Collins in there. Zach Hopkins. Hopkins, let's see, number 41's had a tremendous game. Injured all last year with that shoulder. And he's kind of making up for lost time tonight.
Had a 7.5 sack season at Blinn back in 2018. Still second and goal. Ogeron rolls it out. He tucks it. Not even thinking about passing. Sprint to the end zone. Cody Ogeron finds 6 for the first time this year.
An amazing reach block by the wide receiver, Trevor Begge, on the cornerback. You just can't do it better than that. We talked about Begge and his ability to catch the ball. He had 55 catches coming in, but that time a great block on the edge to allow Orgeron to get into the end zone virtually untouched.
Orgeron, 3 rushing touchdowns last season. A full year as a starter, his first here. Cuts the Tarleton lead down to 8, pending the extra point. Extra point. Fired through. And we've got a brand new ball game nearly in Stephenville. McNeese not going anywhere as they put it in the hands of number 8. McNeese back on the board. Charlton State holding on to a 24-17 lead here over McNeese, but McNeese getting back in it. It's to Cody Ogeron. Ogeron scoring from 5 yards out to cap off a really nice drive, a 16-play drive. This cold, cold night, 27 degrees is all. It feels like it's in the teens with the winds coming out of the north, and you see the ball falling off the tee for the first time for Bailey Rayborn.
Big touchdown right there. Longest drive of the game, 16-play drive, 77 yards. It takes 5.5 minutes off the clock, and it gets McNeese back into this game, and they're going to force Tarleton to respond here.
Right when the Cowboys needed it, for sure. Kalen Horton ranging over, taking it from the 1. Looking to make people miss. Makes the first man miss, not the second. He's pinned back at the 17. A big special teams play coming from McNeese. And courtesy of Mason Caldwell.
The Yeah, Horton's had a really good game. Watch that reach block there on the edge. I just thought Trevor Begge did an amazing job of blocking out in front on Kalen Horton, that sophomore backup cornerback. That was the key to that play. What a great job by Begge.
And Orgeron gets a chance to warm up just a little bit. Cody Orgeron is going to get a chance to play against his dad on September 11th, by the way, as LSU is going to host McNeese in the fall season. How cool is that?
That will be fun.
That'll be a lot of fun. Braylon Bridges is the running back here for Stephen Duncan, the quarterback, and Tarleton back at their own 17. And before this play, flags fly.
Yeah, the play clock hit zero there.
Play game. Number 11 of the offense. 5-yard penalty, first down.
You know, Tarleton was so good in the third quarter. A couple of really big touchdown drives. One of them, it was kind of the Tariq Bitson show. The other one, they were kind of showing off those new legs of Braylon Bridges. What do you want to see from Tarleton here?
Well, you'd like to see at least one, if not two, first downs here. They don't have to score for this to be a successful drive, but they're going against the wind, and they're backed up deep in their own territory.
That's a great point. Tarleton failed to score against the wind in the first half. Little zone read, and here comes Duncan, the big man, rumbling out past the 20. Andre Sam on the tackle.
Sam on the tackle, and he got a great block by Bridges, the running back, from the backside to allow him to get free. That's a nice play and a nice run of five on first down.
And it's going to leave a second down, just about five. Actually picked up 10. Remember, that was a first and 15. So,
yeah, beg your pardon. Yeah.
Duncan getting out and rumbling there. Duncan in his first start, a little consternation on the handoff. Finally gives it to Bridges. Bridges able to finally pick up one on the play. Leaves a third down and four, but that's a couple times where the snap's been there, but Duncan, cold hands or whatever the case may be, hasn't been able to cleanly handle.
Yeah, you've got a freshman running back who seems to be having some problems here. Hasn't looked like a freshman until, you know, a couple of these stumbles at the mesh point, and you don't want that right now with a game in the balance.
Call it a third and three. Duncan going to the air, and Roberson with yet another grab. The career day continues for the sophomore, Dre Roberson.
And that has been a bread and butter play, and it's all set up by the run game with the play action pass off the RPO. It brings the linebacker up. It puts the wide receiver in man coverage. It gets the inside leverage. Great throw and catch.
Another give to Bridges. Bridges breaking tackles, keeping the hand on the ground. Isn't running like a 180-pounder. Bridges very close for the first down to the 44.
Love his toughness, love his vision. There's a lot to like about this guy, Bridges, who has brought it in this, essentially, his first collegiate game here in Tarleton's first game as a Division I participant. But a nice cutback there, takes a little bit of a hit, breaks the ankle tackle, and then lowers the helmet to finish off the run. It's very hard.
5 yards is added to the end of the run. It's first down.
It's hard to teach young running backs to finish off runs. They've got to do it time and again in practice. It's got to be drilled repeatedly. What a great job right there by the young man, Bridges.
Plus 5 yards because of an illegal substitution penalty on McNeese. And you see Bridges' numbers in his debut. He has the 27-yard touchdown run, 9 carries total for 83. Some great production.
Man, he has been solid. He and Banks, Skinner, this is going to be a very strong trio as this season here in the mid to late winter and spring continues.
Well, they come off of tacking it on to the end of the play. It's just declined instead, and a first down for Tarleton. Pulling it back, Duncan, and his receiver stumbles. Tariq Bitson had beat his man, but Bitson falls down. It could have been a huge play.
Yeah, you don't see that happen very often, especially with a guy as talented as Bitson, who just stumbled, as you mentioned, got the outside release, had his man beat on the fly route, and Duncan put a ball right where it looked like he was going to be had he not stumbled.
We have not seen J.F. Thomas in quite a while. The outstanding wideout is on the sideline, and he hasn't been out there. Give to Bridges again. Bridges tiptoeing that sideline and staying inbounds as long as he can.
does it for a 9-yard gain.
Love to watch this back. They run kind of an inside buck sweep where they bring both guards, and what a great job by the young running back Bridges to tiptoe to get the extra. They say he went out of bounds just shy of moving the sticks, but how big has the run game been on this drive? Let's watch this back. You see the guards pulling, and I just thought that the running back did a great job to keep his balance.
And on third and one, Bridges gets the carry again, makes the little wiggle in the middle, picks up two. First down.
And not only did he pick up two, but you don't see guys that can bounce it to the outside. That adept in being able to read, see a hole, get to the hole now, as he did. And I thought that was a bad call because I don't think he stepped out of bounds. I wish they would have gone to the replay on that.
Well, thankfully, Tarleton picks up the first down anyway at the 45. Another give to Bridges. Bridges, patient. Bridges, cutting. Bridges, diving for the first down. And he's also over 100 in his Tarleton debut. Trent Winbush comes up with the stop.
And I'll tell you what a great job right there by Tarleton State. You look at what they've done, and Jonathan Beasley and Scott Carey, the two co-offensive coordinators, what a great play call. They went right back to that buck sweep, the same play that got him the first down. Great job on the play call.
12-yard pickup. Raheem Skinner comes in to give young Bridges a break, and a 1-yard gain for Raheem Skinner, who has had his moments, a touchdown earlier in this one as well.
Love to watch great running backs work. What a nice cut.
Wow.
And then great acceleration. And then again, he just finishes off that run. He's going to be good. It's hard to imagine that Braylon Bridges is a freshman at 5'10", 180 out of Houston, Klein Collins High School. He has been tremendous tonight. And how about 12 carries, 106 yards with the touchdown on his college debut night.
And time is ticking off. Tarleton with a one score lead, zipping over the middle. What a throw, and Gabe Douglas drags it in at the 15-yard line. Duncan putting it on a rope, a frozen one on a frozen night.
Point a bullet to Douglas, and he got Sam again in single coverage on the backside. They run the pose, and they haven't covered that yet. They've been running that repeatedly, and McNeese has yet to really cover that play well. They're trying to guard against getting beat to the outside, but they just keep hammering the post, and it's paying dividends.
Tarleton inside the 15, trying to score again, and pulling it back. Bridges on the RPO. Up the sideline, Roberson. Roberson making men miss. Roberson angling for the end zone, and he's down at the 1-yard line. What a play by Duncan and Roberson.
How about an RPO where you're rolling out left, and then you throw it to the left, what looked like it was a lateral pass.
It's first and goal. Snap to Duncan. Duncan trying to sneak, but he's short.
I want to go back to that last play on that RPO. I'm not sure that wasn't a lateral there.
It might have been.
What a great throw right there, right down the line by Steve Duncan. Look at this. They run the play action fake, pull it, and then throw it. I think that's a lateral ball. If that ball's not caught, it's a fumble, and they get down close to the goal line.
Second and goal at the one. The give.
Wow.
And here it is. Bridges leaning in for his second score. Braylon Bridges picks his way for six, and Tarleton back up by two touchdowns.
Is there anything better than seeing an offense clicking, and how the flow of the game and how the game is called is just a thing of beauty? That was a drive that championship teams and programs are made of. You give up the touchdown, and then you come back, and you just roll it right down the field on a drive that began on your own 17 after a less-than-stellar kickoff return, and you punch it in to regain the two-score advantage, doing it on the ground, and a play-action pass. Great job.
Man, a lot of Bridges on that drive, and the Tarleton Texans are feeling it. Incredible response to go up by 14 in Stephenville. Tarleton State feeling it, up 31-17 on McNeese. John Little back with Scott Garner, high above Memorial Stadium. Just how about the response from this Tarleton team? And how about the response from Braylon Bridges? You know, the play callers put it in the hands of the freshman to lead them down the field.
And he responded, too. How good was he? I mean, he did so many good things on that drive that you don't see freshmen do at this level.
Big kickoff here as Skinner races over. He fumbles it and is able to recover it at the 20-yard line. So it's where McNeese takes over, because it was a response drive by Cody Ogeron and McNeese. It was a big play for them to get in the end zone. And here's the second touchdown of the game. Just tough running by the young man.
Yeah, and you just look at that toughness there between the tackles. He showed that. He showed the nimble footing on that first down run where he was tiptoeing on the sideline that they marked out of bounds. I still don't think he went out of bounds, but he did so many good things on that drive. I love the fact that Tarleton, as you mentioned, responded, but I don't know what was better, what's been more invigorating. The defensive intensity coming out of the locker room to start the second half, or that drive that was just a thing of beauty, that response. Those two were almost one and the same.
And it's all built up to a D1 debut for Tarleton, leading McNeese, a Southland Conference power. Here's Ogeron, looking for anywhere to go with the football, and just has to heave it away over the head of Jamal Pettigrew. Second down.
Boy, his numbers do not look good. 9 of 21, 91 yards, a touchdown. He's got a 95 quarterback rating. Hasn't all been his fault, because in the second half, Tarleton said, you know what, we're going to play man coverage. We're going to lock you up. We're going to bring pressure, see how you handle it. They had a hard time handling it, and Ogeron just has not been on his game. Not all been his fault, though.
Ogeron back to the air. They need a lot of big plays in a hurry. And Ogeron gets bottled up. Brought down for no gain.
And you say, well, why is he taking the sack? I mean, he's scrambling out. He's got his eyes downfield. Nobody's open. There's not a single guy downfield that was open.
Marcus Patton, you saw him there, the defensive coordinator in his fifth year, dialing up an incredible second half to hold McNeese to 7.
I'll say this. They better hope that somebody locks him in for a long-term deal, and they need to keep him. He is fantastic.
Patton's turned this defense around. Here's third down. Ogeron trying to make a play, racing to the edge. Ogeron trying to find Beggy, but short hops him at the 40-yard line. Fourth down for McNeese, and a big three and out for this Tarleton defense.
Man, they are flying around the football. Yeah, it took them several drives to get into it, to find the flow, to find their rhythm, but they found it. And, man, they have not looked back. I love the physical nature of this Tarleton defense. They have hit. Now, they suffered the targeting foul, a couple of targeting penalties. One was not ruled a targeting after they looked at the replay. But, hey, sometimes you have to do stuff. I don't mean that you have to play illegal, but you have to have that physical presence, that physical nature, and you have to have that physical mindset to win these big games.
Snap back to Bailey Rayborn. Rayborn with the win behind him. It's brought in by Horton. He called for a fair catch. Still gets spilled over. No penalty flags yet. But Tarleton up by 14. .35 to play in the fourth quarter. Tarleton with the ball and a 2-touchdown lead. Welcome back into Stephenville, the FCS debut for the Tarleton Texans, going very well for Todd Whitten. He's been the head coach for 11 seasons, 10 seasons previously as a D2 head coach, now officially a D1 head coach. And McNeese, right as we come back, has to take a timeout of their own. Things didn't look right defensively for the Cowboys, who started out so well in this one. And I want to just heap praise on McNeese as much as we can, because, I mean, they're a squad that they have been through the ringer, not only the two hurricanes, but, you know, dorms were uninhabitable at the Lake Charles community. You know, they couldn't have players staying on campus, so they were sent off campus until the middle of November. And when they moved back in, Scott, they didn't even move back into their dorms or their homes, their apartments. They moved back into a hotel.
They did. And yeah, when you have to overcome adversity like that, it's tough. It's tough to get going. I can't believe that they came out and played as well as they did to start this ball game, John. Just making the trip through the ice of Central Texas and getting here, I thought, was a feat in and of itself. They had a good start, but Tarleton has really come on since the second quarter.
Look, you're on Fox Sports Southwest. Tarleton up by 2 touchdowns. New quarterback again, Cameron Burston. And Burston gets a little score time here in the fourth quarter after getting one series back in the second. Time to try to grind the clock away, and the handoff to Raheem Skinner goes for one.
It is, and this is the kind of drive where you want a quarterback to manage the game. I would not be shocked to see Burston try to take this play clock inside of five with each successive snap here. Can you run when the opposing team knows you're going to run? That's what great teams can do, and they've had enough ground game tonight. You look at the rushing yards for Tarleton. They've run for almost 200 yards tonight, 171 to be exact. They've worn out. They know they're going to run. Can they line up and do it?
Here's Skinner again, picking his way. Oh, what a play in the backfield. On the ground, Mason Kinsey, who has had splash play after splash play for McNeese with a big stop. Third down.
It is third down, and Tarleton seeing just a clustered box there. Everybody lined up, 8-9 guys in the box. They know they're going to run here. I would not be shocked to see McNeese call the timeout if Tarleton doesn't get a first down here.
Tarleton facing a third and 10. You see Burston there getting a little bit more time. A senior, he is out of eligibility at the end of this semester. He cannot play in the fall. That's why Tarleton wants to give him as much time as they can.
There's a 110% chance they're going to run this football.
Well, there it is, right to the edge. Here goes Skinner. Skinner backing his way across the 45, and he picks up 7. Not enough for the first down. Andre Sam trips him up. Fourth down now, and we'll see about that timeout. Remember, McNeese had to spend one at the beginning of this drive. That's not when you wanted to spend one if you were McNeese, because the clock was stopped at that point.
Surprise, they're going to hold on to it here. They've got one left, but they can ill afford to have time run off this clock down two scores. I'm shocked that they're not calling it here. They've got one left, but most would burn it here and save the time. But good job. Good job by cutting it back to the middle of the field rather than toward the boundary there.
That's a good point. Walrath on to punt. He hasn't had to do that in a while. They come after him. And that one lands well short, out of bounds near the 35-yard line. So Tarleton bleeds some clock. The McNeese State defense does its job. Now with 4:08 left, it's a tall task for the Cowboys. Can Cody Orgeron find a way to lead them back, or will it continue to be the night of the Tarleton Texans? Just to fire through and decide not to play in the fall, but to play in the spring instead, to endure over the winter months, get here through COVID and everything that both these schools have been through. It's been a really fun night. Right now, it's tipping the way of the Texans. Orgeron back to the air, chased, dumps it underneath and through the hands of his running back Skinner, second down.
Yeah, that's the kind of night it's been tonight for McNeese. They just have not been able to make any plays after that first quarter. And again, with just 4:03 to go, you just almost have to play perfect football from this time, from this point forward, to have any shot.
Has not been a perfect night for Cody Orgeron's McNeese State Cowboys.
No.
7-game season for them. Orgeron back to the air, stepping forward again, the crosser, this time his running back McMahon is popped by Devin Hafford, who has had a day in his re-debut, if you will, for Tarleton.
You know, Hafford had 4 tackles last season, and that's because he got injured in
the
season opener last year. But he's had a tremendous work ethic, one of the top 3 players and maybe in the nation at that cornerback spot that works as hard as he does. Most cornerbacks can't tackle real well. That's not Hafford.
Hafford goes at 210, rare size for a cornerback. 3rd and 6, prayer picked, intercepted for the Tarleton Texans. Benji Franklin takes it away.
Orgeron might have gotten hit late, the flag came out, but he was throwing off his back foot, and when he did, I thought, uh-oh, let's see what happens here, and Tarleton may have their first takeaway of the game.
Just depends on that flag in the backfield. That would certainly seal it with 3:21 to play. The officials taking a look. It's been a busy night for Vidal Jones, our referee.
There's a foul. Running back. Number 90. 50 yards from the side.
Call on Blake Heel, takes off the interception for Benji Franklin, and hope stays alive, at least for now, for McNeese.
Old Dominion transfer, just a sophomore. And we've seen the officials pull that flag out a time or two against Orgeron, get some hits that weren't really all that bad. And
not bad, you know, but a good two steps.
Good two steps, but we saw Orgeron get shoved earlier, maybe a step after, and they were real protective of it.
Orgeron hangs in there, hits Beggy over the middle, but he can't control it to the ground. Oh, I thought Beggy had brought one in, but Bryson Collins.
They brought a flag in, and I think for a target. I didn't think that was even close to targeting, and now there's some words being exchanged down there.
Tempers running hot late in this one.
How about Collins? What a hit. Man, this secondary, I love watching Tarleton play from that all three phases and three levels of their defense have really turned it up since the second quarter. Another big hit.
And Beggy laid there on the ground for just a little while. Hopefully he's going to be okay. He had really high-pointed the ball pretty well. I thought he was about to bring it down.
You see the season's worth of highlights of the secondary tonight.
And in the second half, too.
Man, love to watch these guys fly around. And Collins doesn't even start.
Exactly. He's stepped up today.
Watch this hit.
I just don't see it targeting now. Maybe it was something afterward. Maybe standing over Beggy, perhaps?
Maybe, but I'll say this. McNeese, they've been taking hit after hit. And if there was some talking going on after the hit, if they were trying to rub it in a little bit, I can see McNeese getting upset about it. But
sure.
This Tarleton defense is playing with an edge, and that's what great defenses do. Man, they are fun to watch.
Tarleton opens up with three Division I programs. In fact, they play an FBS program next week in New Mexico State. All right, so it really comes down to whether this was a targeting or not. I thought there was a lot of shoulder there on first thought, but
you know,
well, look,
this is the third one that we've seen tonight.
Yes,
against this hard-hitting Tarleton State secondary. They are as physical as you will see.
Tarleton State still up by 14.
Yeah, so they review it, and no foul for targeting. Let's look at it again. Yeah,
just a hit to the chest, really, with a shoulder, right?
Yes. Might have clipped him a little bit with a face mask, but not enough to warrant a targeting. But I'll say this. We've looked at now two potential targeting that have been ruled not targeting. That's how physical this Tarleton secondary has been playing.
Orgeron can get out and boogie. And Orgeron picks up a first down. Franklin escorts him out. That stops the clock as well with 2:58 to play. Tarleton State has outscored McNeese 31-7 since McNeese got out to a 10-0 lead.
Yeah. You're letting hit so hard that they're throwing flags for targeting, and it's not even close.
All the way over the middle. Great catch. Bringing it in for the score, Mason Pierce. Cody Orgeron leads a big drive, and Pierce with the first touchdown catch of his career.
Got a chance to make it a one-score game again and have with an extra point. Still 2:46 to go. This game is not over, but what it's probably done is it's ensured that Steve Duncan probably comes out for this last drive, perhaps, for Tarleton.
2:50 to play. McNeese able to hold on to their timeout as well, which was absolutely huge. And this one to try to cut it down to a 7-point game.
And had they used it, there would probably still be about 3:20 on the clock rather than 2:46.
Extra point fired through. And McNeese with a response drive to get back within one score. You know, and that's what we're talking about, the fight of these McNeese players. They've had to fight all fall through hurricanes, through COVID, and now they're trying to fight back here.
And hey, listen, Orgeron's made throws. He's only 11 for 27 tonight for 121 yards, but he's made a couple of touchdown throws. He's got a rating of 102, but when he's had time and they haven't brought pressure with a blitz, he's been able to function back there. He's been able to execute. But when he's been forced out of the pocket, not so much tonight.
There's the scoring drive. 5 plays, 65 when they had to have it. Did it in a minute 22. 26-yard touchdown pass from Orgeron. Going up the middle to Mason Pierce. Was in there because Trevor Begge looked like he got a little banged up on the hit that was originally called targeting.
Yeah, remember they had brought out Cameron Burston, the number two quarterback, to lead this squad. And we'll see what Tarleton elects to do here. Will Steve Duncan reemerge? For the fans that have come out tonight, they deserve a medal.
I agree completely. Unless you're in the heated section, then, you know, I mean, you're living in the lap of luxury
heated
if you're in the tents.
Where's the heated section?
If you're in the tents, you're in the lap of luxury.
That's the heated. So it's 40 degrees there rather than the 28 that you're having to contend with otherwise.
Exactly. It's almost too hot in this booth. I could use a little air conditioning as a timeout is called before the onside kick attempt.
Don't say that. You're complaining it's too hot. These people are sitting in a 13-degree wind chill. You're complaining it's hot.
Man, what a night, though. What a night for Tarleton. You know, what a night for McNeese just to get back on the field. Like we talked about, their interim athletic director, Heath Schroyer, also the men's basketball coach, saying it's just a minor miracle to get back on the field. And what's happened there at the Lake Charles campus, and you look at their future schedule coming up here in a couple weeks. They got a break, and then they're right into Southland Conference play. 7 Southland teams are playing, and you see the schedule there. They're going to play, or excuse me, 6 Southland teams are playing. They're going to play each one. Meanwhile, for Tarleton State, they get right back after it, going to New Mexico State, but they may not have to leave the state for that one. More on that in a moment.
Yeah, the Aggies are not able to play and practice over in New Mexico, are they?
And then a lot of home games, 6 of the 8 at home. Let's see what McNeese does. It looked like Rayburn was thinking onside kick, and now he does squib it forward, and
look
this
out.
Is a really tight one. Did McNeese get it back? Sure looked like they did. Yes, they did. Bailey Rayburn executes, running after his onside kick, and the Cowboys stay alive in Stephenville.
Are you kidding me? They get the onside kick, and McNeese hanging in there, being down 14 not once but twice in this game, and they've got a chance to tie, and they've got plenty of time here with 2:45 to go.
Unreal. Now the officials looking it over. Of course, it's got to go 10 yards before McNeese touches it. And I think it touches the Tarleton player first.
Yeah, and the problem is you've got one guy for Tarleton right there.
Antoine Ware.
Going at it. Ware was there, but everybody else kind of standing around. And, you know, if this were a basketball game, you know, you would hear the coach say, hey, when that ball is loose, you've got to get down on the floor and get it. When that ball is loose on an onside kick, you've got to get on the carpet and get that thing. And you only had one purple jersey down there.
So the officials taking a look, making sure this should be McNeese ball.
You care to explain that, John?
Well, I think the bottom line is here that it's McNeese football, right?
He said a lot, but I'm not sure what he said.
Let's try it again. They're going to take a look at it for a review. So that's the bottom line, is they're going to give this another look. So does McNeese touch it first? I don't think so.
I didn't even think that was a...
Was it kicked, maybe? By the left foot? Look at this. Does the left foot kick it for McNeese?
I don't think so.
It goes off the face mask instead.
I'm not certain if you'll have a more discernible shot at it than the one we just looked at, but I think that was pretty conclusive that it's going to be McNeese ball.
I do, too. And plenty of time, too.
Yeah.
Looking at 2:45 to play. 31-24 game. It's been a busy day for not only the referee, Vidal Jones, but also Jim Campbell, our replay official. Oh, maybe another look here. Certainly off Tarleton first, don't we think?
Yeah, no doubt.
And exactly what they want. They want to make contact with the receiver as soon as he makes contact with the football.
If the ball were touched by McNeese, then it would be dead there.
Yeah, no doubt about that one. So McNeese takes over. They are not dead yet. They've been down by two touchdowns twice. McNeese coming back with a 26-yard touchdown pass from Cody Orgeron, hitting Mason Pierce. Then coming up with the onside kick, a brilliant play by Bailey Rayborn. And now Orgeron trying for a little bit more magic. His dad, Ed Orgeron, in attendance. Oh, a free rusher, but a nice drawn-up screen. McMahon off and running inside the 30 into the 25-yard line. What a time to pull out the screen.
A great call against a defense who's been bringing repeated undisclosed pressure pretty much every down in the second half to start drives and on third downs, and they do it again, and it feeds right into Orgeron and the Cowboys' hands. You can't execute a middle screen better than what we just saw.
That's 31 yards all the way down to the 25-yard line, and now McNeese basically in scoring territory with 2:17 left. Inside give, Mason Pierce. Pierce, a speedster, but it's read well by Tarleton, a 2-yard gain to the 23.
Hard to believe this was a game with 6 minutes ago, just 4 minutes of clock time ago, that saw Tarleton go to its number two quarterback. And the Tarleton State Texans have their backs against the wall here. They've got to come up with yet another stop in the red zone to get it done tonight.
Second down and 8 at the 23. Orgeron with the give. McMahon plunging forward. McMahon with the hard running down to the 18-yard line. Leaves a third down, 3 yards to go. Again, the one timeout left for McNeese, needing a touchdown and the extra point to tie it.
Time of the essence here. The ground game has been beneficial for you. You've not done a overly great job through the air, but with 1:10 to go, it's two down territory here.
Tarleton's defense has been so good all night.
Would not be surprised to see Orgeron roll out here.
Third down. Here's the rollout by Orgeron. Eyes upfield. Nobody's open. Just throws it away. Fourth down.
Everything turning out and unfolding as we expected with Orgeron rolling out to get on the edge. The problem is he didn't have an option to run, and nobody was open downfield. It's been problematic for McNeese tonight. That's happened a time or two, and it's gotten McNeese into some trouble. And now the game comes down to this.
It all comes down to this. And McNeese uses a timeout, their last one, to talk about this all-important play. It's a frigid night in Stephenville, the FCS opener, D1 opener for Tarleton. Can McNeese spoil it? Frank Wilson's team looked dead in the water, but credit them for hanging around and making some plays here to make it really fun at the end.
Yeah, and Tarleton just could not put the game away. They went to their number two quarterback with 6 minutes to go, ended up going three and out. Remember on that one drive where they were just trying
three straight runs.
Yeah, three straight runs. Everybody knew they were going to run. And so that stop was so huge for McNeese because it kept them in the game, and they didn't burn the timeout earlier like we thought they would, and they're able to use it right here on this fourth down play. This is a big one right here with 54 seconds to go.
Since they recovered the onside kick, four plays and 38 yards, the big one, the quick screen, the hitter in the middle to Deontay McMahon. And McMahon setting it up for McNeese in a position where they could think about going to the end zone, but Orgeron hasn't pulled the trigger toward the end zone yet. Now it's fourth and three. You got to get three. McNeese now out of timeouts, down by seven. Need the 15 for a first down. Orgeron rolling out again. Orgeron throwing on the run. It's brought in. Great catch by Beggy. First down to the 12-yard line.
Wow.
McNeese stays alive.
They get it to Beggy, who was supposed to be a kind of a bigger part than what we've seen. I believe that's his first catch in the game.
That stops the clock, and then Tarleton's going to stop it and call timeout.
That's his first catch of the game, John. He had 55 catches last year.
Big part of the offense last year, but perhaps Tarleton really focusing on him today. He hasn't been able to get free, but when the game is on the line, they go to the sure-handed senior.
And was there a question when they go to Beggy? He's been sure-handed. You watch this play again. They get him matched up against the linebacker, and he's able to make that grab. What a throw right there by Orgeron on the move. And he hasn't been great on the move tonight, but when he's been able to step in and as he's running and get good extension on those throws, he's been almost on the money every time. And it has set McNeese up here with 46 seconds to play. Time really not a consideration here. They can still run the football if they want. They can do a whole lot. Certainly they'll have four downs to try to put in the end zone here.
The fans here that have braved the bitter cold deserve to get some entertainment all the way to the end, and that's exactly what's happening. The student section excited to try to preserve a Tarleton victory, but it's not going to be easy in these last 46.
I think just for the mere fact that they were down by 14 not once but twice and been able to hang in there and make this thing again, they've got a chance to tie this game with a minute to go. And what a victory for McNeese. They want to finish it off here, and from a Tarleton standpoint, what bitter disappointment this would be should they give up the touchdown here.
Everybody's out of timeouts. The running back's A.J. Carter. But Orgeron wants to throw. Orgeron to the back of the end zone, just lofts it way over the head of Josh Matthews. Second down.
Great coverage right there out of the zone. They run zone coverage with two high safeties and cover it really well. Tarleton has been good running zone tonight. They've been impactful when they get in man coverage, putting pressure on Orgeron. We'll see what they do here on this second down play. I know this, when they have not brought pressure, it's when Orgeron's been able to operate and he's executed the best.
Three coaches in three seasons for McNeese. Four coaches in the last five.
They're running man. They're going man here with one high safety. They're going to put pressure on Orgeron.
On second down, pressure holds up to the end zone. It is caught. Trevor Beggy. Oh, my goodness. What a catch. An incredible throw. And McNeese can tie it with the extra point.
Their best wide receiver waits until the final drive of the game to make his presence known. He moves the sticks on a crucial pass to the sideline, and now on a brilliant catch in man coverage, the field side. What a throw to the wide side of the field by Cody Orgeron, and McNeese has battled back with less than a minute to go, taking advantage of fielding the onside to potentially tie the game.
Two touchdown throws by Cody Orgeron in the last 3 minutes of this game. And now the all-important extra point to try to send us to a tie game. And the extra point
is good. It's 31-all with just 35 seconds left in regulation, and that man is fired up.
I can't believe with 6 minutes to go in the game that McNeese continued to fight like they did on the road in 20-degree temperatures. What a catch by Beggy, and that was not bad coverage.
No.
And that is a very tough throw to make, and Orgeron put it right on the money. They executed. That was a tremendous job by McNeese.
What do you think turned around for Cody Orgeron? Because his numbers were just, you know, looked like they had been just frozen by this frigid night. Did not look good at all, but it seems like maybe he gets a little bit better when the game's in scramble mode, and it's been in scramble mode for the last 8 minutes or so.
Here's what I see. He's a winner. He doesn't care what the score is. He's going to come out and fight every single down. It's very hard to find guys like that. It's very hard to do that.
One hand. That is a one-handed grab by Beggy.
You know, it's not like, you know, the game plan has changed. There haven't been great adjustments going on down there. I just see a will to win and a will to fight by McNeese. And for this team to do that in this situation, in this stadium, on the coldest opener perhaps any team in these parts has ever played in, for them to do this, quite a tribute to their program.
At least since the 1890s, that's what we discovered early. That's the last time we played in the spring. Rayburn pops this kick up. This is a little bit of trouble. Tarleton fields it finally, and Horton goes down at the 18. So not good starting field position for Tarleton. Only 32 ticks left and no timeouts.
I would not be shocked to see a knee taken right here by Tarleton State. They don't need anything bad to happen here. They need to see overtime.
So there is an offside penalty that will be added to it, but still that only takes it out to the 23-yard line. Horton was hoping for a lot more. Of course, McNeese playing for overtime. I do say one thing. Are you surprised at all that Frank Wilson didn't roll the dice and go for two and try to win the thing in regulation? Maybe if he had a timeout, he might have a timeout to call to set up the play.
Conservative coaches never want to put the outcome of a game on one play. If he feel, and there's the victory formation we talked about. However, 20 degree night, you're lucky to be in it. You've made a long trip. Do you think you can, are you better than your opponent on the road? Mm. Do you think that you can execute enough to prove victorious? Do you have enough gas in the tank?
What a game. The first college football game, the first FCS game in the spring in more than 100 years. So, of course, we're going to overtime in Stephenville. Don't go anywhere. 31-all. OT is next. Seeing the coin toss of overtime, the two quarterbacks meeting at midfield. Tarleton has won the toss, elect to play defense. And so McNeese wants to go to the end zone to our right. That's with the wind behind them, this cold 15-mile-an-hour north breeze as the winter storm bears down on whatever kind of country you want to call this. We're having a debate on Twitter. Is it big country? Is it hill country? Is it north central Texas? Whatever it is, we've got a winter storm warning in effect, and we're playing right up to the wire with Mother Nature to go to overtime here in Stephenville. Great to have you with us. I'm John Little with Scott Garner. Scott, just quickly, your thoughts on the rocks and rolls and turns and twists of this game.
It's been a fantastic game. If this is any indication of how Division I life will be for Tarleton State, this is going to be a fun ride for Texan fans. I know Texan fans are a little nervous right now and probably a little bit disappointed to blow a 14-point lead with 6 minutes to go. But, hey, we knew McNeese was going to be tough tonight.
Welcome to Division I, right?
That's it.
You want to play great teams like this tradition-rich Southland program, McNeese? You're going to have to play the full 60, and sometimes
beyond that, 60 with a little plus sign next to it.
I knew that Orgeron was going to be good, and I knew he would be a winner, but he really showed it tonight. When you're a coach's son in particular, you know how to fight. You know those battles. You've been taught this from birth, essentially. And, man, this has been a good game.
It certainly has. Each team gets a crack at the 25 until we have a winner. Orgeron with a handoff to McMahon. McMahon bursts for at least eight. Give him eight, down to the 17.
And McNeese taking advantage of what appears to be somewhat of a fatigued defensive front seven here for Tarleton State. They were flying around earlier, not so much lately.
Second down, same play, same results. Inside the 10, it's first and goal. Chadwick Thibodeau having to make the stop. How much do you think it has to do with Ronnell Wilson being ejected for targeting earlier in this game?
It factors in for sure.
They're going to go right back to it, but before the play, procedure on McNeese.
I'll say this, always an advantage in overtime to be the team that starts on defense first. So Tarleton with a little bit of an advantage, but well, this ground game has been good for McNeese. Continue to keep the hand, the forearm on the receiver when the ball is in the air. You can do a lot of that chucking prior to the ball being put in the air, but once it goes in the air, you got to be careful. I do like Franklin's physical nature. He always seems to be in the right place, but sometimes you've got to know when to release.
Remember Benji Franklin? He had that interception that got wiped off thanks to the roughing the passer penalty.
Yes.
That kept things alive for McNeese. How about that? And another new set of downs, and a little bit closer for McNeese.
And almost had a chance at an interception, and then I thought for a moment that the wide receiver might make the grab.
Ball down to the 5-yard line for the Cowboys, trying to strike first here in OT. McNeese has scored the last 14. Orgeron to the air, has a man, but it's through the hands of Severin Foster. He had a sliver of a step. It's second down.
Orgeron has had a knack for being able to put the ball right where it needs to be. When you think a guy's not open and he gets just a little separation, Orgeron hunts it out, he finds it, and he's able to put the ball on the spot where he needs to. Hasn't always done that tonight, but it seems lately the last three or four drives without the pressure, he's been able to kind of zone in on that.
Second and goal from the 5.
You know, they're rolling him out to avert that pressure.
McMahon, the running back, with the call. A flag comes down as McMahon is down to the 1, but what's the flag all about? Did they have enough men on the line?
It came from the referee, and that generally indicates either participation or it could be a legal procedure.
Legal formation, perhaps.
Yeah.
So they let the play go. It's a good old-fashioned false start. Yeah, a lot of things have drifted McNeese's way to get into this position. They played perfect in the last 5 minutes.
It looked like Charlie Zeno got out of there just a little bit quick out of that tackle position.
Takes it back to the 10. Second down goal for the Cowboys. Cowboys led early, 10-0. Tarleton tied it up. McNeese hasn't led since. Orgeron sprinting. Orgeron tucking, looking for the pylon, lunges.
I thought he lost the ball.
And there is a beanbag down as well, as if he lost the football right up against the sideline.
He better hope he didn't lose it out of the end zone.
And the officials are talking about just that, as Orgeron had it extended out in his left hand, trying to reach for that orange pylon.
It'll come back to the spot where the ball was fumbled. Great play call. Tarleton, they're not disguising their man coverage. And when they go man, the wide receivers ran as vertical as you can with a condensed field in the red zone, and they're just rolling the quarterback out, hoping that he can beat everybody to the end zone, because when you're playing zone, you've got guys there that can run into the ball. There's nobody there when you're playing man coverage.
It's an excellent point. He's Scott Garner. I'm John Little on a frigid February evening. Third and goal from the three. Motion for Matthews. Low snap. Throw for Matthews. Incomplete. Ogeron, just inaccurate. Franklin on the coverage.
Boy, that is a tough throw and a big fourth down coming right here from the three-yard line.
And the kicking unit is coming on right now for McNeese. The Tarleton defense does their job. Backs against the wall.
Big stop. And it's the problem that we talked about the outset of the broadcast about how McNeese the last couple of years has just had a hard time punching it in the end zone. When they get into the red zone, they were at 33% last year. That's way low. They've got to get better at that, and they've got to settle for three.
Jacob Abel, the new kicker this year, out of the hold of Mason Caldwell. The snapper is Trey Vondenstein. And delay of game. And this, by marching it back 5 yards, might give McNeese a little better look at this, basically an off-kilter extra point. Yeah, the penalty's declined.
Boy, that is a tough throw right there, and really good cover. You can't cover better than that without getting a penalty called on you. It was right, you would call that three-quartering a post in basketball. Went right around the edge right there. That really good technique. This Tarleton defense, the defensive backs are really well coached.
Abel did not miss a field goal last season at Butler Community College. To give McNeese the lead. And it's true. McNeese Cowboys have come back from 14 down to force overtime. Now they have the advantage. So the Tarleton Texans get the ball at the 25. A touchdown wins it for the Texans. And Stephen Duncan, a field goal sends us to a double OT.
Raise your hand if you thought with 6 minutes to go in the game and Tarleton up by 14 that they would find themselves down in the game.
Not me. Not me, my friend, but 17 straight points by McNeese State has turned this thing around. Still, at different times during this game, great performances. McNeese, the Cowboys picking themselves up by their bootstraps when they were left for dead, and Ogeron leading them back to now an advantage in OT. And now we get a chance to look at Stephen Duncan.
Yeah, and we were to the point in the game where Tarleton's up by 14 with 6 minutes to go. And Todd Whitten has gone to his backup quarterback. And this game has gone to overtime, and they're 25 yards away. You put it in the end zone, you've got your first win at the Division I level.
What feeder. Freshman running back Braylon Bridges is the man, gets the call. Bridges has had a big game, over 100 yards rushing and two touchdowns. And even with
his small stature,
he just keeps pushing, Scott.
Love watching this young kid, a freshman. What a job he did to extend the game to 14 points on that touchdown drive. He did everything, ran inside, ran outside, tiptoeing on the sideline, getting physical between the tackles. He has been super tonight.
Second down, 5. Another handoff to Bridges. And this time, Bridges is walled in by a bevy of white shirts. No gain on the play. Third down, 5, as Mason Kinsey leads the charge.
And all of a sudden, now you're looking at third down and 5, and if you're not careful, the game may rest on the foot of the former Temple Wildcat standout, Guzman.
On third down, Duncan to the air, pulls it back. Duncan throws up against the sideline and throws behind his intended receiver, the running back Bridges, coming out of the backfield.
And I thought Duncan was very close to passing the line of scrimmage as he kind of took that football and ran. And I thought he was going to run for it. He had a shot at it. But instead, he has made this a very long field goal try of 37, 38 yards should they elect to kick it.
And there is a man down on the field, you see, for McNeese.
I beg your pardon. It's going to be it should be about
27,
37, 38 yards.
Man down for McNeese, and we'll go ahead and take a quick timeout while they attend to him. And a field goal opportunity coming up next for Tarleton to try to force double. Field goal time for the Tarleton Texans here in overtime to try to force a second OT from straight on. A 37-yard try by Adrian Guzman. He's been good from 38. Missed from 50 this direction. Snap and hold are perfect. The kick is on the way. And it is good. We play on in Stephenville, 34 all.
Oh, what a kick. On a night when the wind chill is in the lower teens and that football is as hard as a brick down there, to be able to kick that thing from that distance and be as consistent as he's been tonight. He missed one, but he was close. He also made one earlier. Big muddy kick right there.
He's able to get it up over the line, sneak it inside that left upright to force another OT. And this time it will be Tarleton having the football first.
And I just wonder if Steve Duncan doesn't want that third down play back where he was scrambling and ended up having some room in the middle, stepped up and decided to throw it at the very last moment, only to throw it incomplete to the sideline when it looked like he might have been able to tuck it and run with it.
Steven Duncan, the quarterback for the Tarleton Texans, 21 of 36 for 220 and a score in this one. The touchdown went to Tariq Bitson. And his other favorite receiver today has been Dre Roberson. He has been without J.F. Thomas for the majority of this game. So another first down for the Texans. The running back is Braylon Bridges, the freshman again. Duncan heaves it up the middle. Bitson can't bring it to his body. Bitson versus Joyce, and Joyce wins the battle, and he's down.
Got his hands on it, matched up with the linebacker, and it looked like Bitson landed on him. I bet Joyce has the wind knocked out of him here.
Might be the case. Bitson has made some acrobatic catches in this one, including the one down the sideline for the touchdown.
And Duncan really didn't step into that throw and get good extension on that throw. He's kind of falling backwards with a little pressure coming to him, but still put it on the spot where he needed to.
Tarleton trying to retake the advantage after leading by 14 twice.
And I thought really, it'll kind of landed on him, but I thought really Duncan should have stepped into that throw, had plenty of time to step into it. Sometimes when you get pressure repeatedly on you, you're almost functioning as if you're taking it for granted that you're going to have pressure rather than actually feeling in the pocket.
Learning experiences on both sides tonight. A back and forth game.
And Duncan, the Western Kentucky transfer, he's played at the Conference USA level, played in three games in 2019 to start, got injured, won that job at Western Kentucky, and he's been really good tonight.
Here's second and 10. And Duncan back to the air, this time going right side, and a miscommunication with his receiver, Gabe Douglas, who dug in, and Duncan threw it long. Third down, 10 for Tarleton. It's getting in a troubling position if you're the Texans.
Yeah, Mason Kinsey continues to that high-energy defensive end who didn't play last year, really adding depth to this team. The transfer from the Citadel, number 52, defensive end continues to beat Leighton Ernst, that Oklahoma State transfer at that left tackle spot, putting pressure on the quarterback, Duncan.
Three receivers right on third down, lots of pressure, and the screen pass underneath. Bridges is read like a book. Isaiah Chambers, the transfer from Houston. He comes in and rips down the freshman to make it fourth down.
Boy, he was besieged on that one, just pressure from all over. They had the right play call called, just couldn't quite execute it into the boundary. Too much swarming going on and rallying the football on the defensive side. It was a great play call. Tarleton State now forced to kick it from 45 to try and break this 34 tie.
And again, Adrian Guzman is the kicker, the freshman out of Temple, 2 for 3 today. From 45, this one away. The distance is there. And it's good as well. Tarleton hanging on, leading by 3 and needing a stop from their defense to win it.
Boy, what a kick by the former Temple Wildcat. He's And Temple's been made several runs in the postseason as of late, getting to the state title in two of the last three or four seasons. And he makes another money kick. The former Temple Wildcat banging it through a couple of big-time kicks here in overtime on a night when I guarantee you nobody wants that job as a kicker.
No, there certainly can't be that normal punch on the football. So the Tarleton Texans have gotten back in it and now retaken the lead after giving up a lead of 14. Thanks to two Cody Orgeron touchdown passes in the final 3 minutes of regulation, including a one-handed grab by his buddy Trevor Beggy.
Can't imagine that McNeese would not go back to the ground, would not start on the ground. They've had a lot of success to start drives running that football.
A.J. Carter is the running back, but it's Orgeron instead. And he drifts his way for a good 7 yards, rolling down to the 18-yard line.
Yeah, they show spread formation that time just to try to get the linebackers spread out a little bit, run quarterback power, and pick up 7 big yards.
There's a numbers tonight for Cody Orgeron. A lot of that coming in the final 5 minutes of regulation. A touchdown wins it for McNeese on the road. Orgeron right back to the run, to the 15, to the 10. Orgeron wins it on the road. Cody Orgeron walks it off. And the McNeese Cowboys come back from the dead to take down Tarleton.
And so dead that the Tarleton Texans had gone to their backup quarterback with 6 minutes to go in regulation, only to see the Cowboys score a touchdown, recover the onside, then punch it in again before triple zeros hit to send us to overtime, and the Cowboys coming back to battle and win the game, having been down 14 not once but twice to secure an opening victory.
Cody Orgeron, responsible for all 5 touchdowns tonight for McNeese, leading his team back, and he needs a moment.
Boy,
3 touchdown passes, 2 touchdown runs, and now he just looks entirely spent.
And he looks like his father's son, doesn't he?
He does.
Striking resemblance there. What a night he has had. And Father Ed Orgeron in attendance tonight here in Stephenville. A unbelievable victory for McNeese and a very, very disheartening defeat to Tarleton State, who really at times in the second half, not only better than McNeese, simply dominated him.
Yeah, that was the part that certainly got me, is that Tarleton looked like they had broken the will of McNeese, but McNeese says no. No, the will is here for Cody Orgeron and for the rest of this team to pick up the victory. An incredible win for the McNeese Cowboys. So, for Scott Garner, I'm John Little, saying so long from Stephenville, Texas, where McNeese has defeated Tarleton 40-37 in double OT. This has been a presentation of Fox Sports Southwest and Tarleton State University. Good night, and stay safe.